Okay, here's how this shit is gonna work, okay? On the right here, I have wrote down 100 of my favorite video games of all time, okay? There is no order to this list on the right. Do not freak out. Azura's Wrath is not the greatest game of all time. Bahamut Lagoon is not the second greatest game of all time. Banjo-Kazooie is not the third, and so on and so forth. The list that really matters is here on the left. This is the actual order of everything, right? Jesus, guys, we've already raised so much fucking money. Oh my god. I have divided this list of 100 into 10 special zones, okay? At the start, numbers 100 to 91 are the gates of acceptance. This is pretty cool. If you get into this, you made a good-ass video game. After that, 90 to 81 are the mountains of quality. You made quite a good video game. If you can somehow get past the mountains of quality, you have the Bridge of Killers. This is where we start getting fucking insane. These are some of the best games in existence, but they're not as good as number 70 to 61, The Path of the Elite. Some of the best games ever, which still look like shit compared to 60 to 51, The Doorway of the Best. Only to be diminished by the threshold of brilliance, 50 to 41, which leads to the Stairway of Greatness, leading to the Ascension of the Super Beasts, leading to the Battle on Heavenly Ground, leading to the Domain of God, until finally there is only one left, the Throne of the Undisputed. That's what we're doing here today. But this isn't everything, okay? Because I couldn't fit all the games I liked onto this list. And so, I had to come up with another list called The Shadow Realm. This is every game I considered being one of the top 100 games of all time, but couldn't fit them into the 100, okay? It sounds bad, and it kinda is a bit, but you have to remember, the Shadow Realm is also a place of respect. Good games go into the Shadow Realm. The only way you can make it to the Shadow Realm is if I have enough respect for you to go there, okay? But I have added one more zone, and this is somewhere you don't want to go. I'm dead serious. Going here is the worst thing that can happen a fucking video game, okay? And I want to say to any studios watching this, because I know they're all watching, if your game ends up here, look, it's okay, it's just my opinion, but it is probably the worst thing that will ever happen to you. And that zone is the Dead Zone. This is where I'm going to put any video game suggested by chat that is just, I think, is not a good video game that I do not like. If you guys want to suggest games, you can, but keep in mind, your game could end up in the Dead Zone. Do you want to do that to your favorite? Do you want to do that to your favorite developer? Do you want to do that to your favorite studio? Do you want to have this black mark on their lives for the rest of time? I'm seeing people to scream at me to put Shenmue 3 in the Dead Zone, and this is going to be a positive stream. This is going to be a good, fun time, okay? But I am going to start by entering Shenmue 3 in the Dead Zone. You see the way you can barely read its name? That's on purpose, because you're not meant to see shit in the Dead Zone. Nothing really exists in the Dead Zone. It is a bad place to be. Again, guys, I have to highlight, this is an awful, terrible thing that can happen. Okay, it is so awful to be in the Dead Zone. I can't put any game I haven't played in there. I would never do that to someone. Like, does it even exist anymore? There's no way to tell. Anyway, I don't want to get too negative, but so that's the warning for the chat. If you suggest to me something that you think is really good, be prepared for the fact that it could end up in the Dead Zone, okay? What we got to do now is go through 100 games. Okay. Here's the Shadow Realm. These are all good games. These are all good games. But the games that did not make it into the top 100 are Let It Die, South Park, Stick of Truth, Joe and Max, Super Double Dragon, Tiny Toons Adventures, which is a great fucking game, by the way, and I won't have anyone say differently, Little Nightmares, Shantae and the Pirate's Curse, Deltarune, No More Heroes 2, Muramasa and the Demon Blade, Simon the Sorcerer 2, Dragon Ball Z, Budokai Tenkaichi, which was an ambitious fucking fighting game, and no one appreciates it, Choo Choo Rocket, WrestleMania 2000, Busta Move, Sunset Riders, Fury, Evo, Castlevania, Symphony of the Night, did not make it into my top 100, despite the fact it's a very good game. If I get too many complaints about this, I will put it in the dead zone. Do not make me do that. Do not make me do that. Into the Breach, Tenchu Wrath of Heaven, Haunting Ground, Arkham Asylum, Fury, Hyrule Warriors, The Magical Quest starring Mickey Mouse, Wario Land, Thumper, Metal Slug 3, Day of the Tentacle, GoldenEye, Anodyne, Tekken Tag Tournament, River City Girls, Lylat Wars, Harvest Moon, XCOM Enemy Unknown, Shadow of the Colossus, The King of Fighters 2000, Celeste, Dark Chronicle, SSX Tricky, Silent Hill, Shattered Memories, World of Horror, Final Fantasy VII Remake, and Shenmue 1. Whew. Why is Fury there twice? Because it's really good. That's why. Is Silent Hill 3 Dead Zone? No, Silent Hill 3 fucking rules. That's a beautiful game. I'll put that in the Shadow Realm. Wait, John thinks P4 is better than P5. Lol. Lion Kun, I love you. I appreciate you joining the stream. If you think P5 is better than P4, you're insane, my friend. You are literally insane. Final Fantasy 15 is Dead Zone. Final Fantasy 15 can go in the Dead Zone. That's how things work. Okay, so now, in alphabetical order, I'm going to run down the games that are up for nomination, okay? Azura's Wrath, Bahamut Lagoon, Banjo-Kazooie, Bayonetta 2, Binding of Isaac, Bloodborne, Bloodstained Curse of the Moon, Capcom vs. SNK2, Cave Story, Chrono Trigger, Command & Conquer Red Alert, Cuphead, Danganronpa 2, Dark Souls, Dead or Alive 2 Ultimate, Dead Rising, Deadly Premonition, Deadly Premonition 2, I know, we'll get to it, Detention, Devil May Cry 5, Devotion, Disgaea, Doki Doki Literature Club, Donkey Kong Country 2, Donkey Kong Country Tropical Freeze, Dragon Quest 11, Earthbound, FTL, Fallout New Vegas, Final Fantasy VI, Final Fantasy VII, Fire Emblem Awakening, Full Throttle, Garou Mark of the Wolves, Guitaru Man, God Hand, Gone Home, Guilty Gear Xrd Revelator, Gunstar Heroes, Hades, Half-Life, Hollow Knight, Hotline Miami, Hyper Light Drifter, If Found, Killer7, Lisa, Legend Mystical Ninja, Link to the Past, Majora's Mask, Mass Effect 2, Mega Man 2, Metal Gear Rising Revengeance, Metal Gear Solid 2, Metroid Prime, Monster Hunter World, Mother 3, Mystical Ninja 64, Nier 999, No More Heroes, Ocarina of Time, Paper Mario the Thousand Year Door, Phoenix Wright, Pokemon Blue, Pokemon Soul Silver, Portal 2, Red Dead Redemption 2, Resident Evil 4, Persona 4 Golden, Resident Evil Remake, Secret of Mana, Sekiro Shadows Die Twice, Shenmue 2, Silent Hill 2, Smash Bros. Switch, Spelunky 2, Street Fighter 3rd Strike, Street Fighter Alpha 3, Streets of Rage 2, Super Mario 3D World, Super Mario 64, Super Mario Bros. Yoshi's Island, Super Mario World, Super Metroid, Super Punch-Out, Tekken 5, The Walking Dead, The Walking Dead Season 1, Toho 8, Imperishable Night, Tony Hawk's 3, Undertale, Virtue's Last Reward, Beautiful Joe, Virtua Fighter 4, Evolution, WWE No Mercy, Wind Waker, Witch's House, Yakuza 0, Yume Nikki, and Zombies 8, My Neighbors. That's what we're dealing with here, folks. That is the list. Only other rules to all this are, if two sequels are similar, they do not get multiple spots. So Metal Gear Solid 1, 2, and 3, I picked my favorite among them. I am not going to be debating why I think Metal Gear Solid 2 is better than Metal Gear Solid 3. I have too much other shit to process tonight. You're just gonna have to accept that this is who I am, this is how I feel, and there's nothing that can be done about it, okay? We life is full of difficulty, life is full of hardship, and I want you all to remember that during this stream, because there's going to be a lot of upsetting things that are going to happen. We're all going to be very sad at cuts I have to make, and people are just going to be angry all the time, and that's okay. Friends, those are the rules for tonight. That's what we're doing. Just as a reminder, we are raising money for the American Foundation of Suicide Prevention, and part of me was a little... maybe thought that maybe that wasn't a great idea, because obviously suicide's a really serious thing and I'd never want to make light of that. But I also feel one of the problems surrounding suicide is the stigma of just it not being talked about and it not being discussed. I'm not going to speak personally on any experience I've had with suicide or something like that, because I just don't feel like I really have that life experience to me say so meaningfully. But I also wanted to do a stream to try and take some of the stigma out of it, and that's why I chose it for this, because I think mental health, especially in year 2020, became a really fucked up thing for a lot of people. And so I figured if we're gonna do something, let's do something that's kind of affecting everyone. And the American Foundation of Suicide Prevention does a lot of really good work. They don't just do like outreach in America, they fund studies, they have like hotlines that you can call, they do a lot of work that like just kind of affects everywhere. And so that's why I picked them for the charity. So With that in mind, we're going to do the first 10, and then we're going to get to reading some donations. One more note before we begin. I have to say, this could change dramatically depending on what day you ask me this stuff. This is my ultimate list as of right now. If you ask me to redo this list tomorrow, I would say it would end up differently, especially the first 30 or 40, because like it's pretty difficult to rank like what makes one game better than another, and so I'm just going to be going on instinct and feeling a lot. Okay. And I think the 100th best game of all time. I think I'm gonna go with Gone Home. Boom! It has begun. Gone Home. Really cool game. Kind of like was one of the first and definitely had a big role in popularizing the real like explore 'em up kind of like, I guess walking simulators, a lot of games would call them. I thought it was a really, really well done game. It's beautiful. I think it was like my favorite game I played that year. Looking back on it, when you see the different kind of things that people have done with that genre, I think it's hard to like, it's hard to justify it as like, especially against things like Devotion, which is going to be a real heavy hitter on this list. Number 99. This is tricky. You know what? Number 99, I'm going to go for Bloodstained Curse of the Moon. This is not Bloodstained Ritual of the Night, which would not make it onto my list. And Bloodstained Curse of the Moon is quite simply just one of the tightest games I have ever played in terms of just pure level design. That game is fucking brilliant because its levels force you to really come to terms with like all the different characters' abilities and mechanics and all this kind of stuff, and it's people are already so pissed. I love this. I don't have, I think, like an emotional connection with the game that I would need for it to have go higher than this, but just from a pure level design standpoint, I would challenge you to find like more tightly designed games than this. Fool streamer me say. Guys, it's going to be a lot of misspelling and I'm not even going to apologize. That's just what we're doing tonight. You know what? After this, I think it's actually going to be Red Candle Games Detention. This is the game that came out before Devotion, and it's from a Taiwanese studio, Red Candle Games, and delves a lot into their history and their history in war. I feel like it's the kind of game where if you look at a video on YouTube, you won't appreciate it at all. Okay, we have a suggestion for Mario Odyssey. Is Mario Odyssey one of the 100 best games of all time? I don't think it is. I really don't. Does it belong in the Shadow Realm? Chat, I want to ask you, does Mario Odyssey... No, I'm getting a lot of no's, more than I expected. Because you see, I don't like Mario Odyssey at all. I don't think it's a very good game, which is why I'm so sorry, but Mario Odyssey is going in the dead zone. I don't know how to spell Odyssey. I'm going to misspell it. I don't care. Oh, yeah. Oh, that feels so good. And no one can get angry because this is a charity stream and I'm doing a good thing. I can do whatever I want and none of you can be angry at me because I'm raising money for a good cause. Okay, Detention. If you have not played Detention, I really couldn't recommend it enough. It's a beautiful game and it's just, I adore it. Okay. Number 97, I feel pretty comfortable with God Hand being number 97. This was a game that came out from, I think it was Clover. It was, I'm pretty sure it was Clover. But it was some variant of like the Capcom 6 that came out during the GameCube era. Super good game, kind of janky in its own way and just so weird and stupid, but I love it, honestly. Like it's a really fun game. You create your own combos. It has like an excellent like I think it's Kamiya game. I'm not 100% on that, but I think it is. But it has like, if you like beat 'em ups, if you like games where you just get to kick the shit out of people, it's an excellent one of them. Number 96. Where are we going? You know what? I'm happy enough to drop Deadly Premonition 2 in there. I know earlier I said we weren't doing sequels unless they're drastically different. I love Deadly Premonition 2. It is probably the most problematic game on this list in so many different ways. It is buggy as fuck. It's got kind of shitty representation towards trans people. I'd be lying if I said the game didn't mean a lot to me last year, where I just got really, really into it and got really lost in that world. But yeah, I think 96 feels like the kind of proper place for it, because it is just a fucking disaster. Over Godhand, yes, Bogus Forehead, over Godhand. I don't know if I'm cutting Killer7, but hear me out here, okay? Killer7 is a game that I love that I hate playing. It plays like garbage, even though it is like really, really fun. Like, even though like I respect so much about it, I never want to play it. BioShock Infinite isn't that good, I don't think. I have not played BioShock Infinite, so I can't comment on it. I don't think I'd like it. Okay, no, I think on style alone, Killer7 has to go further. Okay, I think I can put FTL in there. FTL is a game about flying a spaceship. It's a procedurally generated game, so like you never really know what's gonna happen, but it's basically up to you to fly through 4 galaxies, I think, and go from planet to planet, and like a lot of it's just through text, but it's the kind of thing where like the first time I ever played it, I got stranded in space with my space dog running out of oxygen until I starved to death, and it was so good. It's a really cool little game. I'd really recommend FTL if you can play it. I think Into the Breach is a better game, but it's really cool. Okay, number 94. Oh, this is tough already. Okay, I think it's got to be Zombies Ate My Neighbors. Zombies Ate My Neighbors is like a Super Nintendo game. It's super fucking cool. It has a really great style and just like it's really fun to play. I think the only reason it stops this early for me is that it's also a nightmare. Like, it's so difficult. And I always got to this, like, level on it where there were these giant sandworms and it was really scary and I could never beat them. So the game balance is in question. Still a great game. Okay, number 93. 3 spots left in the Gate of Acceptance. I think number 93 feels like a good spot for Undertale, actually. Undertale's like a kind of, it's a good little indie game, and it kind of like, it does some interesting stuff, like it's cute, but I think this is about as far as it goes. No, I'm just fucking around, guys. It's okay. I don't know how many people know my takes here on Undertale, but it's going a lot further than that. A lot further. Okay, you know what? I think it's got to be Metroid Prime. I really, really like Metroid Prime, but it's not my favorite Metroid game. It's not my favorite first-person shooter. It's not my favorite. I just think it's one of those games. I think I nearly appreciate it more than have like a personal connection with it. And so I think it's kind of got to go here. It's like a fucking cool game, and I could see it being way higher on a lot of people's lists. But for me, this is about as far as it goes. Metroid Prime at number 93. Moving on into 92. 2 spots left in the Gate of Acceptance. And I think number 92 for me is actually going to be If Found. I really, really liked If Found. This is an Irish visual novel that came out last year. I was very, very high on it when I finished it. It was actually like, in Let's Fight a Boss, it was actually my game of the year last year. I think the further I moved away from it, the more I kind of appreciate its story, but also kind of find myself maybe wishing that there was more of a game element to it, because like the narrative was so linear. And I think if it had mixed the story with maybe more of the strengths of being a video game, it could go a lot further. But it's a really cool game. It's a really great LGBTQ game. Like, if I think that stuff has kind of led to isolation. So for you, and I think it gets across a lot of that stuff in a really profound, meaningful way. And it's really fucking cool. But I think this is as far as it goes. Later on, I'm going to be pulling up like footage of games and we're going to be talking about specific moments. But for now, I don't want to get too bogged down in that, because we will literally be here all night. And like, it's already like 20 past 10 or 10:20 p.m. as you Americans call it. Okay, this next one's going to be controversial, but just allow me to explain myself, okay? The next cut is going to be Fallout New Vegas. This is a game I started playing very, very recently, okay? And I have not played, I've played about 12 hours of New Vegas, and I've been having a great time. I've been having a really, really good time with it. I know, everyone's going insane, I know. There is every chance that if I got to play like 20 more hours of Fallout New Vegas, it could go so much further up the list, because I think it's a fantastic game, okay? Like, I really do. But in all honesty, when I think of my emotional I'm so sorry, chat, everyone is going nuts. If I think about like my emotional connection with this game, what it means to me, it is like less than a lot of games on this list, but that is because I need to play more of it. And so it's unfortunate for New Vegas. If I did this list in a week or 2 weeks or 3 weeks, it could go so much further than that, okay? So I'm sorry, everyone. I'm sorry. This is as far as Fallout. No, I think it's a great game. I'm going to play some like tomorrow when I'm done with this stream, but that's as far as it goes. Guys, we are at the end of the Gates of Acceptance. The first tenth of our journey is over. We have now reached the mountains of quality. This is where shit starts to get serious. I know I've tried to say that things are serious before. They weren't. Now we're serious. But before we do, I want to read out some donations real quick. Anonymous donated $10. My family has suffered from more than one suicide. I'm grateful that you are doing a stream for its prevention. More importantly, there will be chat as talking about man's mental illness is not an illness that precede it. It will normalize it as a social prevalence seeking help for the people who are suffering. Thank you, dude. That is kind of like a point of this. Like, that is kind of what I wanted to do. And so thank you. I see you donated twice. So thank you so much. Fluffy Delphin? Blessed be the nameless one. By the way, if you're unfamiliar, I am the nameless one. That's what I do on my podcast. I've recently reigned supreme over my podcast. It's very exciting. You're very kind and generous for putting this together. All I am doing is just reading out the names of video games. Like, this is a real easy way for me to do anything. So I don't think I deserve too much credit on it. Like, generally, I think the people who donate are kind of what make it important. Why don't you have a fitted shirt on your bed? You good? I guess I should have that. I hope some of the legacy of Kane games are on your list. Their story is magnificent. I am also hoping for a Why Would You Play. You know what? The Soul Reaver is a cool ass game. Soul Reaver. So I'm gonna put that in the Shadow Realm. Cheeky Chimera, $10. As someone who escaped a mental health abyss in 2019, the cause means a lot to me. Love your videos and love that you really care for those who struggle. Keep it up, both you and everyone pushing through the dark depths of the human psyche. That's really cool to hear, Cheeky Chimera. Thank you so much. And yeah, like, you know, I think it's fair to say everyone goes through shit. Obviously, I think some people, like, they have much deeper, harder struggles than others, and like, if me doing a shitty video game list helps with that even a little bit, you know, I'll know that, like, what I do is not a waste. Lord Killjoy, $10. Gaelic games, football for the PS2 in the dead zone. I think I have played that game. I will happily put Gaelic games for the PS2 in the dead zone. Oh my god, I was not expecting to think of Gaelic games today. A friend tried to make me play it, and I hated it just as much as I hate actual Irish sports. Okay, you know what, guys? I'm gonna stop reading donations there. I will pick it up at this point in future, because we got a lot of stuff left to go. I bought like a bunch of Cokes. So, because I'm going to need the caffeine to be able to do this, because we have a long way to go. Through the Gates of Acceptance, onto the mountains of quality. I think I might be about to do something that's very unpopular. The first entry into the mountains of quality is Hades. Oh, chat, I'm so sorry. Holy shit. Wow, look at you guys. Here's the thing with Hades. I think Hades is a fantastic game. In fact, there are 10 games that I consider the 100 best games of all time that Hades is better than. That's insane. But I hit a point with Hades, and it was just like, It felt like chewing gum that I had chewed. I just felt like I'd seen everything in Hades. I felt like I'd gotten all the good weapon combinations. And doing a run in Hades now doesn't thrill me in the same way that doing a Binding of Isaac run does, or even a Spelunky run. So I guess what I'm saying is I think Hades is amazing, but I think there's like, I just kind of had to get rid of it. I think it's a fucking fantastic game, but I think for me, this is as far as it goes. Okay, 89. Okay, it's got to be Mystical Ninja 64. I really love the Ganbare Goemon series. It's like one of my favorite video game series ever. And this is the Nintendo 64 game of that. And it's basically a... It's kind of like a Super Mario 64 clone. And it's just... It's actually... I want to pull up a video of this real quick because it is really fucking beautiful. Like, look at this. Look at this adorable ass game. Like, doesn't this just make you feel good? Doesn't this just make you wish for a simpler time when the world was not so complicated, when all your allies had not turned against you, and life wasn't a screaming nightmare? Because that's what it does for me. Better than Hades. Better than Hades, motherfuckers, and there's nothing you can do about it. Okay, look, everyone here knows how I started on YouTube, and that is that I started an anime YouTube channel, and... Therefore, it shouldn't be any surprise that when I was a teenager, the game Dead or Alive 2 Ultimate meant a lot to me. I am not going into what I mean by that anymore. You figure it out for yourself, okay? I had a lot of fun games of this against my cousin. One time me and him sat down and I swear to God, we played 120 matches in a row, and it was fucking brilliant. It was one of the best experiences with a fighting game I've ever had. And I will never not be able to think of, like, getting a PS2 for the first time and playing Dead or Alive 2 and just, like, it being so far ahead of anything that could have existed on the PS1 or N64. And, yeah, that's my justification for it. I like it. Dead or Alive Ultimate 2, better game than Hades. Fucking deal with it, everyone. Just look, in a year, you'll all have come down from your weird, horny Hades high, and you'll all be like, you know what? Mystical Ninja 64 and Dead or Alive 2 Ultimate are better than Hades, okay? Like, everyone is so mad, but there is the odd person in the chat being like, thank you for doing this. Thank you for ruining everyone. And hey, Dead or Alive's a great fighting game. I won't hear any shit talked about Dead or Alive 2. It's a legit good fighting game. Okay, it's Command & Conquer Red Alert 2. I know there's going to be like one person freaking out about this game getting cut. It's my favorite real-time strategy game of all time. I think it's fantastic, way better than Hades. You know, I'm starting to think I maybe placed Hades too high up this list. I'm wondering, should I drop Hades down some more? Like, is Hades really better than Fallout? No, I'm gonna stop. Command & Conquer, it was really good too. One of the things I really love about the game is it had these old FMVs. This is what the cutscenes of Command & Conquer look like. And I swear to God, when this game came out, this was the most incredible shit. This was amazing looking. Guys, we have smashed our donation goal. We Jesus Christ, we are $84 over our donation goal. That was so fast. Oh my God. Well, I guess I don't have to do this anymore, so thanks for that. I was getting kind of tired of it, honestly. So there you go. The top 13 games out of 100. Thanks everyone for now. We'll keep going. But that's really incredible, guys. I know I'm kind of playing the heel here, as I am reticent to do sometimes, but that is, you know, it's a really good cause, and it's so fucking weird to me that, like, we hit it and we're not even like a fifth of the way into this stream. So yeah, but Hades is a shitty game. People think I'm nice because they watch my videos and they think I'm nice, but like, when I can't edit myself, I'm a fucking dickhead, and I know it. Like, I have a lot of really nice friends, and they're all like, you know, you're kind of a nightmare. And I'm like, yeah, no, I know. Like, you can listen to the podcast for more of that. Okay, number 86. We're gonna do more donation readings at the end of this. I wish I could cut Hades again. It just felt so good the first time, you know? Okay, I think next is gonna be Full Throttle. This is a really old LucasArts point-and-click adventure that I adore. It actually got a HD remaster, which I have not played, I was obsessed with this game when I was little. I just thought it was the coolest fucking thing. I'd like to believe it holds up well, but a lot of the games from that era do, so I'm hoping it does. And yeah, Mudclip, I got stuck at the guys where you need to fight guys on the bike, so you need to throw sand in the woman in the with the chainsaw's face. I got stuck on that for a long time. Oh, Tofu Boy 44 is after suggesting Crash Bandicoot. Is Crash Bandicoot one of the 100 greatest games of all time? So we're talking about Crash Bandicoot for the PS1. Guys, I don't think it is, which means we have to go down to the Shadow Realm. Does Crash Bandicoot belong in the Shadow Realm, or does it deserve to go even lower? People don't think I'll do it. People don't think I don't have the fortitude to put Crash Bandicoot in the dead zone. Well, get a load of this. Crash Bandicoot is in the dead zone. No one can stop me. I can do whatever I want. I am God in this reality. And everyone just has to accept it. Guys, that's what happens when you come into this without thinking. When you suggest a game, you need to think carefully, because look what can happen. I bet Naughty Dog is getting, like, I know it's like, it's early on a Saturday, but I bet Naughty Dog just got an email that their first ever game just got dead zoned and they can't believe it. They're probably shutting their doors. Like, I would not expect Last of Us 3, because that is a blow so devastating they will never make it. Okay, let's keep it moving. Number 85, Killer 7 still needs eliminating. That's a good point. That's a good point, buddy. Is there a Quantic Dream game on this list? There is not. There is not. I have very complicated feelings towards the Quantic Dream games, and they are definitely not 100 of the best games ever made, but they're not good enough for the Shadow Realm. I genuinely don't think they belong in the dead zone, and it's for one reason. They are ambitious as fuck, okay? Like, they're not great games. David Cage seems like a moron. His stories are bad, and he is a bad writer, but I respect the ambition of those games. Okay, next cut is going to be Guilty Gear Xrd Revelator. I love Guilty Gear. I love the Guilty Gear universe. I love its characters. I love everything about it. If I at any point said that, like, I could play any Guilty Gear game with a degree of competence, I would be lying. I am bad at those games, and I have never fully understood their mechanics, and I want to, but it is a barrier that I feel is, like, so high, and so for that reason, I gotta cut Guilty Gear Xrd Revelator, just because, like, again, it's my personal connection to this game. I love it. Baikin is one of the all-time best fighting game characters ever. I love her so much, but I think, considering that things are getting a little tight here, it's gotta go. Next up, I know this is going to piss people off as well, but the next cut is going to be Hollow Knight. I love Hollow Knight. I think it is a game that so far surpassed my expectations. Like, I really went into it expecting nothing and just loved it. The art style, the combat, the gameplay, it's all great. I have not beaten it, and I don't like being lost. I know, everyone loves Hollow Knight. I know. But I've got to be honest. It's like, it's a cool game. It is not what I consider one of the best 75 or 85 games in the world. And we've got, look guys, I'm sorry, but we got to get cutting. I can cut Hades again if that would make people feel any better. That is a position to be proud of. That is really good, and I cannot wait. And I need to go back and beat Hollow Knight, and there's every chance that could go up, but that's as far as it goes. Okay, you know what? I wasn't going to cut Monster Hunter World for a while, and then I remembered the fucking egg missions. Monster Hunter and Monster Hunter World is the game that made me give a shit about Monster Hunter. It is an amazing game. Its quality of life improvements actually brought me to the point that I can finally, after three attempts on three different games, appreciate Monster Hunter. It's beautiful, it's great. I hate collecting eggs, I hate looking for tracks, I hate that so much of the game is barricaded behind, like, having to search out these tracks when I just want to kill giant monsters with my friends, okay? But it's gotta go. It's gotta go. There are two games on this list that will not make it out of the mountains of quality, and I think one of them is Super Mario Bros. World, Super Mario World 2, Yoshi's Islands. Really great game. I went back to it last year and actually felt like it didn't hold up as well as I thought it would, but beautiful art style, really interesting game, like it a lot. But it's like my maybe fourth or fifth favorite Mario game over 3D World. 3D World is maybe 3D Worlds is maybe the best 3D Mario game. Just marinate on that one for a little bit. I don't fucking care. I'll say anything. No Galaxy. You know what? I'm not actually a big fan of Galaxy. I'm not gonna put it in the dead zone or anything, but I don't even like it enough to put it in the Shadow Realm. I don't think that's a great game. I think it's okay. It's fine. Part of me is saying VLR, Virtue's Last Reward, but I do fucking love that game. Oh, okay. Let's see if we can find something that can replace Virtue's Last Reward for the 81 spot. People are saying, does VLR really go before 999? That is a difficult, because to me, 999 is a more complete experience. I think 999 does what it does better than Virtue's Last Reward. Virtue's Last Reward is also a way more ambitious game than 999. That's tough. That's really tough. Yeah, guys, I think it's got to be one of those two. You know what? I think it is actually going to be 999. I think 999 goes at this point. 999, one of my favorite visual novels ever. Absolutely adore it. Beautiful game, touches off some really interesting concepts. I think the only thing that lets it down for me is I don't think the character writing is that interesting. I think it's a bunch of very average characters put in a really interesting situation, and I think VLR edges it out a little there. I think there's better characters in VLR, but I also think 999 has one of the strongest atmospheres of any game I've ever played, and a lot of that's down to the music. The soundtrack fucking rules, and I love that. Guys, we have made our way past the gates of acceptance, through the mountains of qualities, and we have reached the bridge of killers. This is a huge, huge achievement for every game that's made it this far. But before we continue our journey, we have to keep going through some donations. Joey, $10. As a person who suffers with mental health, I appreciate this enormously. Sorry for the small amount. Months have been rough, but I keep up the amazing work. Thank you so much, Joey. And yeah, I hope things get a little easier for you, dude. Last year, which, you know, the quarantine and everything, it's just a nightmare on everyone's mental health. I think everyone is, like, suffering with this shit. And that's kind of why I wanted to, you know, do something mental health related. And I hope this helps even a little bit. And $10 is a lot, dude. Like, thank you for that. Like, it's really fucking cool. What's a good artsy movie? A good artsy movie. Angel's Egg. Go watch Angel's Egg. That fucking rules. You won't know what happens in it, but it doesn't mean it's not an amazing movie. Carelessly, $10. Love your videos, love your streams, and love the cause. Thanks for doing this. Would love to know your opinion on Final Fantasy IX. Great game. Really great game. And the only reason it's not in this list is because I think it's just similar enough to Final Fantasy VII, where I don't feel the need to conclude 7, 8, and 9. But yeah, End of Ava is the greatest movie ever and I made, and I love you, and I actually agree with that. That is my favorite movie of all time, Evangelion. End of Evangelion. I've watched it exactly twice because I only want to watch it once, like every 10 years, because I just love it so much and I never want it to become routine. I never want to be able to say the lines with the characters. I always want some mystery around that. Uncle Grandpa, hope you're having a good one. Please don't put Yakuza 7 in the dead zone. Oh, would I be crazy enough to put Yakuza 7? Would anyone put Yakuza 7 in the dead zone? Because, like, I think Yakuza 7, it's not a bad game, you know? It is, in some ways, demonstrably worse than the other Yakuza games. Some would argue that it has started off a terrible precedent for the series. Some would say that maybe people are willing to look past all the bad things about Yakuza 7 because they're so in love with the concept of Yakuza. But maybe Yakuza died at judgment. I'm curious, should Yakuza 7 go in the Shadow Realm? Interesting, a lot of yeses. Boy, people sure would be upset if I put it in the dead zone, wouldn't they? That would really sour the mood of this stream. I think Yakuza 7 is an okay Yakuza game. And I think it's a fucking terrible RPG. In the dead zone it goes! Oh, that felt so good. That felt so good. Oh, no one can get mad. This is all for a good cause. This is all for a good cause, you know? That's my cousin Brian who just raided me. He's a good dude. He's actually playing through Undertale right now. I was just explaining to everyone how Yakuza 7 isn't a good game at all. Like, it's kind of shitty, but it's fine. Anyway, let's get back to reading some donations. You know what? We're actually gonna come back to John Walker's question in a little bit, because I think that's gonna... I think I've already poured enough salt on chat for the moment, and I need to... We need to keep things posy. This is a positive evening, everybody. So, getting back on track. Number 80, The Bridge of Killers. It's weird, like, when you read through the list, it's like you read it and you're like... Every round, it's like, no, no, no. And sometimes it's something feels really solid. You can't imagine cutting it. And then as things get more desperate, slowly you feel yourself softening on things and being like, I think we can start to let that go. And it's weird. And I think I know what's going to go next. The first entry into the Bridge of Killers is Fire Emblem Awakening. Absolutely fantastic game. Love Fire Emblem Awakening. Tharja and Long Ku, two of my favorite video game characters. Absolutely fucking brilliant. But I have one major problem with this game. I think this is a game with great characters with a really meh story. I think the story has a really interesting plot twist, and if you've played it, you know what it is. But I do think that, like, it's not the full package. And I like the game. I like the gameplay in it. I think the gameplay is way better than something like Three Houses, which I think has really meh gameplay. But yeah, that would be my justification for this. Number 79, VLOR is next, I think. I feel like we kind of already talked a lot about VLOR, and it's a great game, but I think it can't really go much further than this. It's kind of a pain in the ass in a lot of ways. It's a very awkward game, but it's still incredibly worth it. And, like, I think the way it explains things like string theory and all these, like, really out there concepts is fucking amazing. And I also think the cast is generally a lot stronger than 999. I love the voice acting as well. The voice acting of the weird bunny rabbit is so, so good. It's, like, one of the best, like, villain voice acting I've ever heard. I think Deadly Premonition goes here. It's a broken game with a lot of personality. Also has some really weird treatments of, like, a kind of trans character. And I don't like that about it. But it is so fucking weird and broken and kind of beautiful in its own way. There's a really good video essay on it. It's called Deadly Premonition More Than Just So Bad It's Good. I can't remember the name of the person who made it, but it's really worth a watch because it shows you how strangely mechanically intricate the game actually is, and I'd recommend that. So number 77. Okay, Killer 7. Killer 7 for sure. Really interesting game with a ton of flaws. It has maybe more style than nearly every other game on this list. I have no idea what is going on in that story, but I can appreciate there's something kind of fucking beautiful about it. It's not my favorite Suda 51 game, but it's my second favorite Suda 51 game. It's cool. This is as far as it goes. At 77. Hell yeah. Okay. I'm sure this is going to be an unpopular one. Number 76 is going to be Cave Story. I love Cave Story. I really, really love Cave Story. When I was headed to a con last year, I replayed most of Cave Story on my Switch on a plane, and it was still really good, but I think when I originally played Cave Story, it was like the idea that this was made by just one person was so fucking mind-blowing, and I think it's lost some of that now that indie games are such a big thing, and indie games are so big in part because of that game, and it's great. If you haven't played it, you should check it out. It's like a piece of game in history, and it's got some of the fucking cutest pixel art you'll ever see. But yeah, I think this is as far as it goes. Okay, I think the next one for me is Hotline Miami. I feel like Hotline Miami in a lot of ways kind of brought, like, style in games to nearly a new level. Like, it's not the visuals, it's not the soundtrack, it's not the writing, it's how all those things coalesce into one just amazing fucking package that I really loved. Playing it is really fun, but, like, I don't think you can even watch a Let's Play of Hotline Miami and get what's so good about it. Like, you have to be in it experiencing every part of it at once, and I think it's a really cool version of that. Do you know the only thing I think is better about Hotline Miami 2 than Hotline Miami 1? I think the soundtrack is actually better in 2. It's fucking incredible. Okay, next we are cutting Portal 2. Portal 2, I think, has some of the best writing in any game I've ever played. I think it is, in a lot of ways, a less tight package than Portal 1, and I don't think the puzzles are as good, but I think just for the Cave Johnson segments and how much they squeeze out of, like, I know they kind of milk GLaDOS a lot in Portal 2, but as one of my favorite game characters ever, I did not mind at all. I did not mind. Okay, next, it's gotta be Azura's Wrath. Oh, but does it? Chat, give me some input here. How do you guys feel about cutting Azura's Wrath? Get it out of here. Yes, please don't. Meh, fair. Let it keep going. Okay, look, we're gonna let Azura's Wrath ride. We're letting Azura's Wrath ride, okay? You know what? I think I can cut Garou, Mark of the Wolves. I love this game. It is one of the best fighting games ever. I think for me, my love of this game nearly comes from more an appreciation, because I've never been at a point in my life where I've known a bunch of other people also super into Garou and all of us play it together. I think if I had that, I would like... It would be one of my favorite games of all time, but I've never been at a point in my life where I am actively trying to get better at that game to beat other people. All my experience of this game comes from beating Arcade over and over and over. And it's an amazing game with some absolutely beautiful sprite work, and I wish they made Garou Mark of the Wolves 2. I don't think that's ever going to happen, but it's fucking incredible. I'm seeing you gotta cut 3D Worlds, but do I? I think Banjo-Kazooie... I think it's gone far enough. I love Banjo-Kazooie. I think when you, like, it was such an amazing game at the time, but when you get further away from it, I feel like when you look at what that did compared to what a lot of other 3D platformers did, I think maybe that's where it falls down a little bit. It's a great game, but I think this is as far as it goes. Whew. I feel like all these games deserve to go higher than this, but it's like, it's just fucking impossible. Like, there's just not enough room. Okay. Next, I think it's gotta be Hyper Light Drifter. One of the coolest games I have ever played. I love the feeling of this game. I think it's like the way it tells its story with... Okay, we gotta get some Hyper Light Drifter up on screen. So I don't know, like, if you guys are familiar with this game, but like, it is one of the best looking games I have ever seen in my life. It is so beautiful. Look at that. Holy shit. It's all, like, just pixel art, and it is just some of the most beautiful, like, not just pixel art, just art I have ever seen. Like, just absolutely gorgeous. Look at that. S-rank color design, S-rank animation, just so beautiful. And the crazy part is, like, you look at it, and it's like, okay, I will play this game on how gorgeous it looks. It plays so smooth and so nice. And I never, like, dug into the story, but it seemed like there was shit going on. Like, it seemed like there was a lot of fun stuff. I feel good about it going here, but yeah, excellent, excellent game. And that's it. We've made it past the Bridge of Killers onto the Path of the Elite. We've done it, guys. And you know what that means. It is time for more donation readouts. Okay, John Walker. I haven't watched the podcast yet. Thanks for the spoilers. Anyway, thanks for doing this. Quick question. Where Shovel Knight? I mean, I don't know, where do you guys think that Shovel Knight should go? Just curious, where should Shovel Knight go? What's wrong, guys? Why is everyone looking concerned? Don't you fucking dare. Don't dare do what? Shadow Realm. People want Shovel Knight to go to the Shadow Realm? That's interesting. I'm going to do a poll real quick. The vote's going to last 2 minutes. And I will put it in whatever position gets voted in. let's check the results. Whew. This is a tough one. It's, it's close. It's pretty close here if we check. It looks like Shovel Knight might actually be headed to the dead zone. And that's not what... I don't know that I would have placed it there. But, I mean, this is up to you guys. I let you pick this. And it seems like people are going to send Shovel Knight to the dead zone. Wow, that, you know, a little harsh maybe. But, I mean, what can we do? You know? What do I think of Shovel Knight? I don't think it's very good. I don't like it very much. But the dead zone, that's... I mean, that's harsh. That's a defiant statement. Shovel Knight ends up in the dead zone. The chat voted Shovel Knight into the dead zone. I'm appalled, honestly. Really shocked at that. I guess that's what you guys wanted. You wanted that. I know people are upset, but now I mean, I guess what can we do? Anyway, why don't we read out a few more donations for this super good cause, okay? It's a very positive stream. We're all kind of keeping it cool. Again, wouldn't have been my choice, but that's what you guys wanted to do. So, I mean, who am I to say no to that? I can ask a question. Can you consider Xenoblade Chronicles OG? I mean, I've played Xenoblade Chronicles. Is that what you're asking? Are you asking me to run the numbers on Xenoblade Chronicles and see where it ends up? Oh, man. You know, I wasn't going to, but I'm starting to get a little itchy. No, I'm not gonna put it in the... No, it's safe. Don't worry about it, guys. Next donation. It's going in the dead zone! It's going in the dead zone! Xenoblade Chronicles is going in the dead zone. And I have a very specific reason for this. Let this be a lesson to any fucking RPG that feels a need to implement shitty MMO combat. MMO combat is only a thing because the internet was bad and we had to make bad combat to go with it. Okay? I don't like that combat. Everything else about Xenoblade Chronicles, mwah, fantastic. That combat, terrible, and so I'm delivering a message. Xenoblade Chronicles is in the dead zone. Okay, I'm gonna read a few more donations. I can't just keep pouring salt all over chat. Razcal L, $15, just doing my thing to help out. Great idea with the stream. Don't worry too much about chat. Those are your... Oh, I am not worried about chat at all. Me and chat are getting on magnificently. I was a little surprised that they voted Shovel Knight into the dead zone. Personally, I wouldn't have done that, you know? But I'm also, you know, I get that I've made some controversial decisions and I had to give in to them at some point. What say we get back to what we're doing? Friends, we have entered the path of the elite. This isn't baby bullshit anymore. This is a big fucking deal, okay? This is huge. Every game past this point, everything that came before, garbage, especially Hades. But Path of the Elite, this is some real life-changing shit. We still have a long way to go tonight. I'm gonna be exhausted tomorrow, but I'm having a fucking great time. I do really enjoy just hanging out and being a heel. It's like my favorite thing. I was actually just talking to my partner recently about, like, just a lot of... I've been thinking about a lot of life shit. Hitting a million subs makes you... Makes you think about life in a lot of ways, because I know that's something a lot of people want. But the truth is, you hit a million and it's like one of the most anticlimactic things in the world. But I was recently thinking about, like, if I could do everything again, what would I do? And, like, that's with the knowledge I've already done YouTube, like, and that I like doing that and that it was cool. I think if I was younger and I had, like, the confidence I do now and, like, the wherewithal I do now, I would without doubt go and train to be a pro wrestler and just give it everything I had. And I don't know that it would work out, but I would fucking love to do it so much. And I think doing these streams is, like, the closest I can do to just playing a heel wrestler, and I have such a good time doing it, especially for shit like this. If I'm talking shit about your game you like, it doesn't mean I actually dislike the game. I'm just having fun. Except Hades, which is actually a shit game. Skynia, please spell emblem right. I'm gonna cry. Sure thing. Let me see. Where is that? Here it is. I'll just correct that real quick, because you were saying that kind of bothers you, and I don't want to cause anyone in the chat unnecessary stress. There we go. All better. Okay, Path of the Elite. Let's go. Which is the 70th best game of all time? And I think I gotta go with Sekiro Shadows Die Twice. I've been eyeing this one for the last couple. I think it's a really cool game. I would challenge people to come up with a more intense, frightening moment than the battle with the Azura Ape. And I'm not gonna spoil it, but, like, if you've played that battle, you know that there is quite possibly the most pants-shitting moment in video games. I think it's a brilliant game. I think its story is a lot simpler than the Souls games and really suffers. I think Miyazaki is amazing, but I think his stories are better in the shadows than they are all out front, and it's a fucking fantastic game. It should go without saying that any game from this point on is absolute pure gold, and I could probably talk about it for hours. I could make videos about basically every game left on this list. Tony Hawk's has made it this far. Tony Hawk's has made it exactly this far. The next game we are cutting is Tony Hawk 3. I love this game, and I think, you know, I could argue that the remake of 1 and 2 is actually better than Tony Hawk 3, but I think when you take the Tony Hawk series as a whole and the impact they had back then, I felt like Tony Hawk 3 was the peak of that series, and it was the peak of some really fucking cool cultural shit. Like, it was like, it was this moment that skater culture just broke into the mainstream in a way that was, like, so fucking good. It was a beautiful game in so many ways, and I think of it very fondly, but I think 69 is the right number for it. Next up, it's gotta be Azura's Wrath. I love it. I can't in good conscience let it go any further. I love its story. I love its characters. I love Azura as a character. The moment where he holds his little fucking baby girl and he's this god of rage and anger and passion, and he doesn't know how to quell her crying, it's beautiful. The fucking fist bump, I'm not going to spoil anything, the fist bump of Azura's Wrath, and how that, like, you hitting X being this, like, little, oh, one of the best moments of any game I've ever played. I love Azura's Wrath. I know Wooly doesn't like it. I know Matt doesn't like it. I'm sorry, but Wooly and Matt can go fuck themselves, because Azura's Wrath is a beautiful game and I love it, and I hate anyone who doesn't like it. I mean that. I personally hate you if you don't like Azura's Wrath. Raylag666, you must be new here. This list lacks Xenoblade Chronicles. Oh, buddy, it doesn't. We actually have Xenoblade Chronicles here, and it's just not on screen. You will find that the Dead Zone actually contains Xenoblade Chronicles. It's right there, buddy. It's right there. Oh, this must be like the most aggressive, angry charity stream there has ever been. Okay, Bahamut Lagoon next. Nobody knows what this fucking game is. It is one of the best RPGs on the Super Nintendo. I could even make an argument for it possibly being maybe the best RPG. You could make an argument for it being the best RPG. I'm not saying it is. I'm saying it's like, that's how good this game is. It is up there. I don't know if there's even an official release for it. I think it might be a fan translation I played, but it's this game with branching storylines, with great characters, with this, like, really interesting kind of dragon system. It's kind of like a combination between, like, Pokemon and, like, a more standard, like, Tactics Ogre kind of thing. It's brilliant. Is Kingdom Hearts Dead Zone material? I have to be real about Kingdom Hearts. I don't like Kingdom Hearts. I think those games play like garbage, and I don't think they're very good. But I... it's too weird for me to put it in the Dead Zone. Like, it's too fucking stupid, and as dumb as I think it is, I respect how individual it is, and I respect that there's nothing else like it, you know what I mean? Like, there's nothing else like Kingdom Hearts, and I think that's cool, even though I never want to play through one of those games. And I've tried multiple times to play them, and I don't like them, and I don't like their stories, and I don't like their writing. It's too weird for the Dead Zone. The Dead Zone has to have integrity, guys. It has to has, like, it has, there has to be, not everything can go in there. I thought we cut Persona 4. Did we not? I guess we must not have. I am guessing people are going to be very upset over this. I like Persona 4 a lot. I think Persona 4 is a cool game. There's things about it I don't like. I don't like the writing for a lot of the character arcs. I feel like a lot of the time, I know people are upset. I feel like a lot of the time, it kind of comes to this thing where it's like, the character's solution is fitting into society, and I'm not a big fan of that. Now, saying that, there's stuff I really do dig about it. I think it has the best characters of any Persona game. I think it has one of the coziest, most comfortable settings. It has a great atmosphere, has a really good soundtrack. It's a really, really cool game. It's a lot of people's favorite game ever, but it is my 66th favorite game ever. So I did this before and we got to number 70 and I stopped there. And so we're past that now. And I kept meaning to do it, but then like enough time went by. So I was like, fuck it, let's do it again. But God, this is really difficult. Next game we are cutting is Witch's House. One of my favorite horror games ever. Fucking brilliant game. Made by one dude. No one even knows much about him or who he is. Kind of just appeared on the internet one day. A little indie RPG maker game. And if you ever thought that an RPG maker game couldn't be scary, I implore you to go play Witch's House and play it by yourself alone at like fucking midnight. It is a freaky ass game and I think I really, really liked it. Holy shit, the Magfest board of directors just resigned. I feel like maybe this isn't the point to discuss this, but I've been following that very closely and I am shocked. Okay, I'm gonna have to dig through that later. Magfest is a hugely important con to me and I was very concerned to see like, wow, oh my God. Okay, next one, I think it's gotta be Spelunky 2. I have played more Spelunky last year than I think I played any other game. Me and my cousin Brian do co-op in it and I went from not understanding Spelunky to just seeing why especially game designers love that game. Oh, has Wooly raided? Father Wooly, John is mean to Hades. I'm not mean to Hades. I just think it's a fine game and it is, I don't even think it's fine. I think it's good. I just think it's the 90th best game ever, you know? And like, who can argue with that? It's the 90th best game ever. You know, it's not in the Shadow Realm. It's not in the Dead Zone. It's just here. But Azura's Wrath is a way better game than it. Like, it's just undeniable. Like, you cannot even fucking doubt that. Yeah, no. Hades has its merits. It's for some people. I mean, personally, I am kind of like of a more intellectual kind of type of person. You know, it's not just kind of mash the buttons and succeed. But Spelunky 2, beautifully designed game. Like, if you care about game design, I think people should check Spelunky 2. Again, I could talk for hours about it, but I think 64 is about the right place for it. Bebop Rocky asks, hey bro, kind of a tangent, but are you still doing BJJ? I am still. Well, actually, I'm not. I haven't done BJJ in about a year. That's Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. Basically, just because Ireland's in fucking lockdown and our country is currently riddled with the pandemic and it's had to stop. I miss it so much. I've had so many weird conversations with my friends about this, but like, I am not me unless I can like fight, and I miss just fighting and rolling and sparring so, so badly, but like, there's just nothing I can do about it, and like, I just kind of have to accept it for the moment. And I want to go back like the second the gyms open up again, but yeah, it sucks. I miss it so, so much. Okay, there is one game that I felt good about cutting here. What was it? Okay, next game we are cutting is Mega Man 2. One of the best games ever, easily. Absolutely fantastic game. I think like a real technical achievement, but I think moving forward, every game has to be like just that absolute killer. And this is the only one I can like, this is the only one I can pick out where like, okay, I don't think I can say that about this. Love the game, spent so many childhood years playing it, but that's it. Okay, next up is Dragon Quest XI. Here's my justification for this. I think Dragon Quest XI is like nearly the ultimate like 9 out of 10 game. Everything about that game is good. The characters are fun. The gameplay is great. It looks beautiful. Its world is really interesting. Its story is pretty good. But I would say Dragon Quest XI, the only thing it's missing is that really personal X factor to just push it into like one of the best games of all time. And what I mean by that is I feel like it is a game meticulously crafted by people who know the fuck out of RPGs and have just made this like beautifully polished experience. But for me, it's maybe missing that kind of personal touch that makes a game or any piece of art really, really beautiful. And I still love it, and I still think it is like one of the best crafted games I've ever played. But yeah, I think it's just missing that X factor to go further. Oh, that was a tough one. Like, yeah, someone's saying that Dragon Quest XI is kind of a reboot. If anything, it makes me more excited for 12. Yeah, I want to see them do something fucking crazy and weird for 12. Like, they have such a good setup now to do something like that. I don't know if they will, but when Dragon Quest gets weird, it can get really weird. So let's hope. Okay, one more before we get to the doorway of the best. which game does not make it into the top 60 games ever, and I think it is Donkey Kong Country Tropical Freeze. I feel like everything I just said about Dragon Quest XI, oh dear, I have messed this up. Everything I just said about Dragon Quest XI, I nearly feel like I could say about platformers and Tropical Freeze. Maybe the best 2D platformer gameplay-wise. I think it's amazing. I think its levels, the way they like build thematically on each other, are like just fucking incredible. But if you maybe played the original Donkey Kong Country Returns and you haven't played Tropical Freeze, you do not understand what an amazing step up that is. And so I love that game. It hurts cutting it. We are getting to the point now, chat, where I am the one being hurt. This is hurting me. It makes me sad. Those are such, like, Dragon Quest XI, and they could have gone further, but there's just more. And with that, chat, we gotta go read some donations. Kellen, $5. Do you have any plans to talk about Evangelion on your channel again? Oh, I was thinking recently how if I ever did, like, a full Ava video, like a proper Ava video, that might be the last video I ever do. And I'm not sure about that, but I just feel like Ava is maybe my favorite anime ever. It is the center of so many things for me, and I don't know where I would go or what I would be after an Ava video, because I think that would emotionally annihilate me. Like, it's weird, but like, when you make videos about things you really care about, there's like this weird emotional fatigue that comes with it. Like, whenever I did my videos on Dragon Ball Z or Yu Yu Hakusho or even like that last Undertale video, I was like emotionally like wiped out for like weeks afterwards, and like I feel like I'm only recovering now. Like I had to take a lot of time off after that Undertale video because like the burnout was fucking real. And then like it kind of coalesced with hitting a million as well, and kind of hitting a million also took a weird toll on me that I was not expecting. But I think Ava might just annihilate me. So I think it's inevitable I do a big Ava video. I don't know when, and I think I'd have to be kind of in the right place for it, and I don't know if I'd ever make another video after that. It's a weird one. But yeah, at some point an Ava video will happen. Ian Blacker, $15. Joined the stream late because I am in Australia and miss a bit, but was wondering if Breath of the Wild has or deserves a place on your list. Breath of the Wild. Legend of Zelda, Breath of the Wild. I don't know, chat. What do you think? What do you guys think of Legend of Zelda: Breath of the Wild? Do people like that game? Is that like a popular game? I'm not gonna dead zone Breath of the Wild. Breath of the Wild is good. I don't think it's good enough to make the Shadow Realm. I get people love it. I respect it, but I respect it more than I like it. Okay. Now, we're going for the doorway of the best. Here's where shit gets even fucking realer. We got a question about Hades. Hades is number 90, which I think is pretty good. I think Hades is a very good game. I just think there's 89 games that are better than it. And I know everyone's all in love with Hades and everyone really likes it, but in a year or two, I think you'll all kind of come around to my way of thinking. Okay, number 60 is going to be Danganronpa 2. I love Danganronpa 2. Some of the twists at the end of that game were the hardest, most fucked up swerves I've ever experienced in a video game. There was a point where I knew what was going on, where I thought I knew what was going on, and it pulled back so hard and kept pulling back and revealing and revealing. And I played the whole thing in this 4-hour chunk, as in like the end, and it just like, it destroyed me. It was fucking great. I see people asking about Celeste, and Celeste is not on this list, but I will happily put it in the Shadow Realm. Not top 100, but a damn fine game. This is nearly hard because I feel like this is less about like these games having any kind of flaw that I can pull out to dismiss them, and more so just like how raw I feel about each one, like which ones get me really fucking excited and which don't. Okay, next cut is going to be Doki Doki Literature Club. I love this game. There's nothing bad I can say about this game. I don't think there's anything wrong with it. I don't think it has any faults. It is a really fucking cool visual novel horror game. But when I compare it to the other like genre defining shit on this list, it just doesn't hold up to that standard. I love it. If you haven't played it, go play it. It's a lot of fun. I think it's free. There's some pretty troubling content in there, so make sure you check that out if you're sensitive to that kind of stuff. But I absolutely love that game. Okay, at number 58, and this hurts. This hurts me, okay? I am not happy about this. Is Yume Nikki. I adore Yume Nikki. One of, like, in a lot of ways, one of the most important games of all time. I think it's fucking brilliant. But I think, like, when you look at that game and what it is, it's like an experience in a lot of ways, and I could absolutely see it not clicking with someone. It's just so hard for me to justify that tiny game, even though, like, that's part of what's cool. Like, it's really personal and it's sad and it's important. But it's really difficult to, like, do I think it's better than Yakuza 0, Wind Waker, WWE No Mercy, Virtua Fighter 4? I do not. And, like, I love the game, but I cannot push it past them. Oh, this is hard. This is really hard. Okay, moving forward. The number 57th best game of all time. I think it's gotta be Disgaea. I think if there's one thing I could knock it for, it's like the characters are great, the story maybe not so much, but I love the gameplay. I think it's still the best Disgaea. I haven't played a better Disgaea. Ultra Force raises a good point. Is Super Punch-Out actually better than Wii Punch-Out? I would say yes, just because I think Super Punch-Out is a better feeling game, but yeah, I could see the argument there. I think Wii Punch-Out is a lot more a complicated game in some ways. Okay, this is gonna piss a lot of people off. But I gotta do it, okay? The next game I'm cutting is Pokemon Soul Silver. I think in a lot of ways, this is the best Pokemon game that exists. I love it. But I also think it's in Soul Silver, you can see my biggest problem with Pokemon. Okay, I know. Let me finish. What I dislike about the Pokemon series is it evolves at a glacial pace, okay? And Soul Silver is in a lot of ways the encapsulation of that. It's like, it is a remake of Silver, which was so similar to Blue and Red, and there's so much good shit about it. And I'm gonna remind you how many like other games it is above, and like, I'll get to Blue. I see people saying like, how is this above Blue? We'll get to Blue, but we are not getting to Blue for a while because Blue is one of the best fucking games ever made, okay? We will get to that. But I feel like what Pokemon Soul Silver does well is it perfects a lot of the concepts introduced in Blue, but what it is not is an evolution of Pokemon, and I still feel that Pokemon is suffering from that. Every new Pokemon game is like a quarter step forward, and I want something new, and I feel like I can hang that criticism on Soul Silver as well. It's a better game. Like, I'm not gonna argue. Like, if someone wanted to play original Blue over Pokemon Soul Silver, I'd be like, no, dude, if this is your first Pokemon game, play Soul Silver. It rules. But that's not what this list is. This is about the games I feel super strongly about, and I gotta... Foxcade, get the fuck out of my chat. I've warned you about coming by these streams. Get out of here. I do not want your opinion. Don't anyone acknowledge Foxcade. He knows he shouldn't be here. So yeah, Pokemon Soul Silver at number 56. You can hate me all you want. I'm cool with it. You can't hurt me at this point. I am hurting myself with this list. Okay, next item. Oh my god. So I'll tell you what happens, right? Like, I'm looking at this stuff and it's like, I'm feeling each video game. I'm feeling my affection for each video game. And it's like Bayonetta 2, still feel real strong about that. Bloodborne, still feel real strong about that. That Capcom vs. SNK 2, still feel real strong about that. But then you look at something, and you look at Binding of Isaac, and for the first time in this entire thing, I have, like, felt my resolve waver on Binding of Isaac, and I did not think that would happen so soon. Hades better than Isaac? Get out of here. Get the fuck out of my stream. You're not welcome. You are just not welcome. Shit, I think it's Binding of Isaac. I think it's actually Binding of Isaac. I can't believe that's not making it further. Oh. I see we have a question in the chat about Nier Automata. That's a pretty popular game, isn't it? People really like Nier Automata. What? Why is everyone so upset? Why is everyone scared in the chat? I'm just talking about Nier Automata a very popular game. I think what people are scared is going to happen is they're scared that I'm going to type Nier Automata into the Z zone. You know, kind of like this. And that's what I would do if I thought Nier Automata was a bad game, but I actually really like Nier Automata. I have problems with it, but it's not like a game I hate or anything. It's actually a game I wish I understood more than I do, and it deserves a place in the Shadow Realm. I'm actually going to replay Nier Automata soon, and I'm going to play it all the way through because I want to like that game, and there's things aesthetically and thematically I love about that game. I don't like the characters that much, and I definitely don't like it as much as Nier 1, but yeah, for now it gets a place in the Shadow Realm. Who knows, maybe in a year we do all this again and it actually goes higher. Nier, oh, we have a spelling correction. It's N-E-I-R. Okay, let me change that real quick because I don't like these lists to be sloppy. There we go. Someone asking why I don't like Yakuza 7 because it's a terrible RPG. It's an okay Yakuza game and a terrible RPG. The tone, will you make a video explaining why you dislike Yakuza 7 in more detail? Probably not. Just because, like, I don't have the passion in me to make a full video about Yakuza 7, which is, a 70-100-hour game. And it's not like I hate the game, I'm just deeply disappointed by it. And there's stuff I like about it, like, Ichiban's a cool character, but I think the gameplay in it sucks so much, and maybe at some point I'll talk about it, but I don't know. It seems like the kind of video that would also get a lot of hate, and that stuff can wear you down over time. Next cut is going to be Phoenix Wright, the game that got me into visual novels. It's such a good game. I really, really enjoy everything about it. I love the art style. I love the character designs. I love Edgeworth. Edgeworth is one of the best. He's just fucking Lawyer Vegeta, and I adore him. There's so few games on this list I can even think of pushing it past, and it's gotta go here. It's gotta go. Why is Shenmue 2 still there? Why is one of the greatest games of all time still there? I mean, you tell me, you know? I mean, Shenmue 2, you just can't beat it. Okay, next on the list is Gunstar Heroes. I know most of you aren't gonna know what this game is, but I also know there's probably two or three of you right now screaming your fucking heads off. I love Gunstar Heroes. It's such a weird, unique platformer / shoot 'em up / fighting game, and it does it all with such amazing style and flair. The only argument I can give to it not going further just being I think there's more influential, better games on this list. It is such a beautiful game. Like look at the fucking love in it in the chat right now. That is how great this game is, and it's Treasure who are a fucking treasure of a studio. They are brilliant, and I love it. I think it's their best game. It's one of the best games on the Sega Mega Drive. This is as far as it goes. Oh, fuck. You know what I did? I just realized the next game that's going is Bloodborne. I love Bloodborne. I don't like it as much as Dark Souls. And I think one of the only reasons I feel okay cutting it is there's what I feel like is a really basic... I know. It's not bullshit. You're all fucking insane. No, let me finish. With Bloodborne, the one thing I fucking hate about this game is I hate how you run out of blood vials and bullets, okay? I wish they just regen. Can anyone offer me a good explanation for why it works like that? Because it, to me, that just adds all this completely pointless, just grinding and unnecessary shit to an otherwise nearly flawless game. And I love it. Like, Orphan Akos, what a fucking amazing boss fight. The Murgo's Wet Nurse, incredible. There's so much great shit about this game. Some of the best art direction out of any game I've ever played. I think the way they reinvented the Souls formula was fantastic. I could see, this is Brian's favorite game ever, and I have no fault in that. For me, I just prefer the gameplay of Dark Souls because I like to have slow, heavy weapons, and that shit is difficult in Bloodborne. So, which game do I think is better than Bloodborne? Which game do I think is number 51 on this list, but also not one of the best 50 best games of all time? Okay, I know which it is. This is going to be another very upsetting one to a lot of people. Okay. At the very front of the doorway of the best, just barely not getting into the threshold of brilliance, is Earthbound. Okay, I'm just gonna let chat explode for a second. I have recently played through the vast majority of Earthbound. This isn't like some hot take. This is something that I have, like, I've replayed it for the second time all the way through. It's a fucking great game. It is fun. It has heart and soul. It's weird. It's beautiful. It did things so differently from a lot of shit back in the day, okay? It is good. But when you think about Lisa the Painful, when you think about Undertale, when you think about especially Mother 3, I feel like all those games took what Earthbound did and kind of moved it on to the next phase. And when you have played all of them and you go back and play Earthbound, to me, it's hard not to feel like something's missing. It's hard not to feel like the battle system isn't really that interesting. It's hard to feel like maybe the story doesn't really have a whole lot to say to me. In my opinion, I feel like maybe the story, like, and if there, like, is there anyone in the chat who can honestly say that Earthbound even comes close to Mother 3? Because to me, Mother 3, like, Mother 3, we're talking fucking top 10 game. And I don't want to, like, get into, like, what games I think are going to be top 10. But Mother 3 is as close to perfect as a game has ever been. Like, this is super harsh, but Red Vidson says, Earthbound is a crumpy, quirky Dragon Quest game. And I kind of agree with that, especially when you compare it to Mother 3, okay? Okay, let's get some donations in. Red for Quals. Missed most of the stream, but thank you. This is an awesome cause. Your vids have helped me through rough days since uni. You're beautiful. Thank you so much. Sometimes people ask me, like, what the target audience for my videos are and stuff. Like, this, someone asked me this during an interview during the week. And, like, the thing I always say is, like, the genuine purpose of my videos is, like, I think of it like someone comes home from, like, a shitty day at work. Like, they are in a bad mood. Things are going wrong in their personal life, whatever. I like the idea that they can just sit in front of my videos for 30 minutes and just forget about their fucking problems and just be able to zone out and just get a little escape from reality. That is all I am trying to do with my video. I don't see them as educational. I don't see them as, like, teaching people things. I literally just want to give people a little break from the kind of horrifying reality that is, like, the modern world. And so when I get messages like that, it does mean a lot. So thank you. Hey John, I love your videos. I'm sad. Sad you think VLR is better than 999, but I respect your opinion. Also, my art history professor watches your videos and uses them in class. Lol, have it. Jesus Christ. I always feel like if society has gotten to the point that educators are showing students my videos, we are fucked. Like, forget the Four Horsemen of the Apocalypse. The fact that they're using some B-grade Irish anime YouTuber to teach young people things is terrifying. So we're at the threshold of brilliance. These are not fucking games anymore, my friends. These are art. This is some real ass shit. And I know I say this every, but, like, literally everything we just talked about, toss it in the garbage. Nothing compared to what's coming. Okay. At number 50... we're gonna drop Cuphead. Brilliant game. Absolutely brilliant. Amazing gameplay. Maybe the best art, the strongest art style out of any game on this list. If the platform sections worked better in Cuphead, I think I could nearly push it higher. It's hard not to think about, like, how frustrating those sections are and how good, like, compared to how good the rest of the game is. I have, like, a video on Cuphead that you can watch, but it's a fucking cool game, but I think this is as far as it goes. I think the next game I gotta cut, and this really hurts, but I think it's Beautiful Joe. Such an incredible amount of style, so much fun to play. There's so much shit to love about this game, but this is kind of as far as it goes. It's fucking brilliant, but yeah, it's a shame. I don't think it's ever been re-released on anything except the PlayStation 2 compared to the original GameCube. Maybe they were actually released at the same time, I don't remember. But some of the best boss battles, some of the most interesting gameplay mechanics. I love that game. But yeah, I think I gotta leave it here. Henshin a gone gone, baby. Okay. Okay. I think next, this is gonna be unpopular as well. The next one is going to be Metal Gear Rising Revengeance. I adore that game. I love it. I think it's brilliant. It has some of my favorite boss battles of all time. The battle with the Senator at the end. just, I think there's things about the gameplay I don't love. I don't think it's Platinum's strongest game. The soundtrack is amazing. I don't disagree with anyone in the chat saying it's a masterpiece. I love it. But I think when you compare it to just everything else on here, for me, it just doesn't hold up. And I feel good about it being there. It's hard, but yeah. Oh no. Oh no, I think I know what's coming next. Oh no. Oh, this is gonna be bad. Okay. Guys, I think the next game I'm going to cut is Chrono Trigger. Okay, look. Look, here it is. There is no way I'm ever going to make the argument that that Secret of Mana is a better game than Chrono Trigger. It just flat out isn't. Story-wise, character-wise, it's just not. Gameplay-wise, Chrono Trigger beats the shit out of Secret of Mana. I love Chrono Trigger. There is an X factor to just the atmosphere of feeling of Secret of Mana. And like, it's related to a lot of really personal shit with me. For me, Chrono Trigger is a really excellent game, but I also just do not... I've never had quite the reverence for it a lot of people do. I think it's a really, really, really... Like, you could take everything I said about Dragon... No, that's not true. Chrono Trigger does do some amazing shit. With their main character, with time travel, with like, it's got a killer soundtrack, it has beautiful character designs by Toriyama. I love Chrono Trigger, just not as much as I love 46 other games. Doki Doki is still on the list? No, it's not. I don't think Doki Doki Literature Club is a better game than Chrono Trigger. That would be insane. I'm not ready to cut 3D World. I think that's maybe the best 3D Mario game. But man, maybe I'm not that far off either. Oh! Jeff just had an interesting suggestion. Jeff just suggested the Resident Evil 2 remake. Where should the Resident Evil 2 remake go? That's an interesting question, I think. Oh shit, we're at the bottom of the top 100. I guess the Resident Evil 2 remake didn't make the top 100. That sucks, but surely we can find a place for it in the Shadow Realm. Surely. Right? Is Resident Evil 2 remake as good as Tiny Toon Adventures? I don't think it is. I don't think it is as good as Tiny Toon Adventures. Oh. What? What's this? We're at the bottom of the Shadow Realm? But wait. What's this? The Dead Zone? Does the Resident Evil 2 remake belong in the Dead Zone? No, that's impossible. That's impossible. I mean, it's not like the Resident Evil 2 remake took Resident Evil and made it a fucking action movie. So what's better than Chrono Trigger? Okay, you know what? I'm actually second-guessing myself. I think I am going to cut Super Mario 3D World. A lot of people don't like this game. I've seen a lot of people say they think it's, like, the second worst 3D Mario game. I think that's insane. I think the level of creativity in that game is fucking beautiful. I think it does so much with, like, how it works its levels. Every level feels new and interesting. I love it. I like it better than Galaxy. I like it better than Galaxy 2. I love... Me and Michelle played through a ton of it and just had a, like, great time. I think it's, like... a meticulous video game. There's nothing bad I can say about it. I don't think there's anything bad about that game. I adore it. I think it looks beautiful and I can't wait to buy it again. Okay. I think at this point I can get rid of Super Metroid. I'm guessing this is also going to be a very unpopular choice, but look, I love this game. I think it's fucking brilliant. It has this feeling of just really intense, like, just loneliness and being alone on an alien planet. And I think it was one of the first games to ever really nail that feeling. And it's beautiful and the music's incredible. And like the way it all unfolds and play out. It is the blueprint of so much shit that came after it. And I love it, but I think it's so difficult for me to push it past any other game on this list. Because, like, I played through it once and it took, like, you know, 8 hours and that was it. It's hard to justify it, but it's kind of what I feel at this point. Oh, Otter Slinger has a really interesting question, chat. Where's Psychonauts? Where's Psychonauts on this list? I said I wouldn't dead zone it. I don't remember saying that. But no, you know what? I like Psychonauts. Not enough to be on this list, but it is a Shadow Realm game. Okay, I have made my decision, and this is a tough one. I think it's got to be Donkey Kong Country 2. This was my maybe favorite game growing up when I was little. I love the atmosphere of this game. It takes the world of Donkey Kong and makes it like dark and scary and weird. I love Diddy and Dixie as characters. I think they're the most fun Kongs to play as. I think it's way better than Donkey Kong Country 1 and 3. I love it. I think when you compare it to other like 2D platformers, mechanically it doesn't have the depth that like a Super Mario World would have, but I do think it also completely outstrips Mario World in terms of atmosphere, in terms of music. It's a really great game, but I can pretty much make arguments for every other game on this list over it, and so I think I'm gonna have to cut it. Is Red Dead Redemption 2 on this list just to make fun of Dad and Sons? If I want to make fun of Dad and Sons, I can do it way easier without that. Not that I would. Well, I'd make fun of George because he's really fun to make fun of. But Matt and Liam are two of the biggest sweethearts I've ever met. So no way. Oh, okay. I fucking hate this cut. I really hate this cut. Okay. But I think the next game I gotta cut is No More Heroes. And this hurts me, chat. This hurts me. But I gotta be honest. I went back and I played the No More Heroes remaster recently. And that game is a lot rougher than I remember. Like, a lot rougher. And if you're losing your mind at this, it's like, you should go back and play it and see if you have the same experience. But, like, there's a lot of weird effects in that game that I think worked back then, don't work now. There's this, like, hit delay whenever you hit someone, and it feels super weird. And for all the personality and all the style of No More Heroes, it's so hard for me to, like, hold it up to things like, okay, like, let's look at the games that surround it. Metal Gear Solid 2, Mother 3, Nier, Ocarina of Time, Paper Mario 1000 Year Door, fucking all 10 out of 10, like, near flawless games. I just can't let it go further. Even though I think I love this game more than a lot of other shit on this list, I have to be able to justify it somehow. So away it goes. And it hurts. It hurts. I love this game so much. And you know what? In that same vein, I'm going to cut The Walking Dead Season 1. I think an absolutely revolutionary game for its time. One of the best stories I've ever experienced in games. The way that game comes together, and like there's a scene in the last episode where it's you and you sitting with someone you've unintentionally wronged. And it is, to me, was some of the most powerful shit I'd ever experienced in a game up until that point. Clementine is the absolute fucking best. I love that little girl. I wanted to protect her. I wanted everything to be okay. I thought they would go one way and they went a complete other way. Beautiful game, beautiful story. I bet it's aged badly. I bet the tech behind it is not fun, and like there's game-breaking bugs in it. The way Lee was such a sweet, compelling character, and he was really good to control, and some of the like shocking moments that come in like episode 2 and episode 3 were just incredible. And I love that game. I have such fond memories of that game. It's one of the first games that me and Michelle like played together and really like loved together. And that was a huge part of it. But I also think it's the kind of game that allowed that to happen. Okay. Next up, at number 41, is Super Punch-Out. I think maybe some of like the cultural stereotypes have not aged super great. But I think it's like, it's not one of the best boxing games ever made, it's one of the best puzzle games ever made, in that each enemy of that game is a puzzle you have to crack. I would put it slightly above the Wii Punch-Out, even though I love Wii Punch-Out, because I think the feeling of punching people is so much better in Super Punch-Out, and I think the art style, the animation is much better in the Wii version, but I think the art style is stronger on Super Punch-Out. Fucking fantastic game. If you haven't played it, it's on the SNES Classic, and you should. And just take time and like figure out like all that game has to offer, because it is great. Oh, that takes us to the stairway of greatness. We have 40 games to go, and let's just, before we read out some, let's go straight to reading some donations. From CMM, we got $5. Hi, my boyfriend is loving the stream. From the girlfriend of the guy who ruined your visits to Insomnia Coffee Shop. Oh no, that was lovely. So basically, I was recognized in Insomnia shop that I sometimes went to, and you guys were super cool. Like I've pretty much never had like a bad experience with people in person. Like I don't mind when people come up to me. I don't mind when they like, you know, hang out, and I do my best to like, you know, take time when I can and just hang out with people. I always remember one of my favorite interactions ever was actually the first fan who ever like recognized me, kinda. I was selling art prints, and I've told this story on stream before, so sorry for hearing it again. I was selling art prints in an artist alley. I got talking to this girl about Hunter x Hunter, and she was like, it's like, oh, who's your favorite character and all this kind of stuff. And I was just like chatting away to her, and she was like really nice. And then eventually she goes, oh, actually, you know what? You should watch this video. This was like before my face was out there and all that kind of stuff. She's like, you should watch this video called Why You Should Watch Hunter x Hunter. It's like 50 minutes long, but it's you'd still enjoy it. And I was like, oh, I wrote that video, because I didn't know how else to respond to it. And she looks at me and her eyes go like really, really wide. And she just goes, you write for Super Eyepatch Wolf? And I think I was just like, yeah. And I just didn't know what else to say. And it was like, it was one of the cutest interactions I think I've ever had with a fan. I've had a lot of weird interactions with fans, but like never negative, just always memorable. I'll put it that way. Oh, I think I know what I gotta cut soon, and it hurts, but I gotta do it. Okay. Hell yeah. The first entry into the stairway of greatness. It's gotta be Streets of Rage 2. I fucking love that game so much, but it's an hour and a half, like, scrolling beat-em-up. You know, if you want to talk about, like, games that have, like, style and, like, a kind of swagger to them, Streets of Rage 2 is one of the earliest and best that really meant something. It was this fucking Sega Genesis game that had like house music in it, that had club music, that was going out into culture and taking the grimiest, like edgiest shit people could find and actually turning into its own thing with Yuzo Koshiro's soundtrack. And it's beautiful. It's such a fantastic game. The only way I can find fault with it is looking at the other games on this list and comparing it to them. Okay. This next one hurts me so much, but I feel like I have to do it because I just can't find a meaningful reason why it can compare to any of these games. I am cutting Shenmue 2. I am aware of what Shenmue has become over time, and I know in hindsight how fucking silly those games look, but you have to understand, when those games came out, they were a fucking new world for video games. They were a whole new thing, and like, it's so easy to go now and look at the near nonsensical game design and like the laughable voice acting, but the reason that stuff is so fucking broken is because there was nothing even attempting anything close to that when Shenmue came out. And to me, Shenmue 2 is the much better game between Shenmue 1 and 2. For as much as like, I'll laugh at it when we do the Let's Plays and Let's Fight a Boss, when I think of like shit that just had me mesmerized in front of like a gaming console, Shenmue 2 is it. I cannot find very many arguments when there's a list like Link to the Past, Mother 3, Red Dead, Resident Evil 4, like it's just not gonna happen. But in its own way, I think Shenmue 1 and 2 are still beautiful games, and I still think they're worthwhile. But I gotta leave it here. Why is Bloke Pokemon Blue still here? Because it's one of the greatest, most influential games of all time. You fucking heathens! Okay? That's why it's still here. Next up for the cut, I think it's gotta be Touhou 8 Imperishable Night. About as perfect a game as there is on this list. I'm not like huge into Touhou, but I'm huge into Imperishable Night. I think it's such a fucking glorious mix of really cool visuals and amazing soundtrack. It's like a shoot 'em up game. It's like a bullet hell game if you haven't played it, and it's just joyous. And I think out of any game I've ever played, it is the most flow state inducing game You know, like you zone out and you just hit that zone and it's incredible. It's so, so good. And I love it. And it's like another one of those ones. It hurts so much to cut it, but I just gotta. Fuck. Oh, God. Okay. I think I know what I gotta do next. Oh, this sucks. This is bad. I don't want to do this. Don't make me do this. I gotta cut Nier. Nier is a beautiful game. You know that like old cliche of like more than the sum of its parts? I think in a lot of ways, Nier, and I'm talking about original Nier, I'm not talking about Automata. Nier is such a beautiful story and it does do so much interesting shit with its gameplay. I also think a lot of its gameplay is kind of bad and like the pacing of some of the dungeons is really bad. To me, it's the game that did like the whole flip perspective thing. Now you see things from the enemy's point of view. It did that better than any game I've ever experienced and I adore it. And that party might be my favorite like party of an RPG. You know, you got Kaine, you got all the other guys, Emil. It's just beautiful. There's so many fantastic cutscenes with like those characters forming relationships and it's fantastic. It is so good. Maybe it deserves to go higher. It's really hard for me to say, but just every other game on this list is just so fucking solid at this point. I think it has to end here. Do you recommend tracking down the original or playing Replicant? Personally, I am not a big fan of Brother Nier. I feel like that dynamic gets a little kind of pandery in a way I'm not into when it's Brother Nier. But it makes more sense thematically as Father Nier. But each to their own on that one. Like, people's mileage is going to vary. Okay, next cut is going to be WWE No Mercy, the greatest wrestling game of all time, a fucking defining cultural moment in my teenage years. I poured like dozens and dozens and dozens of hours into No Mercy. It was fucking brilliant. They have never made a WWE game that's even come close to it. So me and my friend, right, our Saturday night was we would order pizza. We would set up a pay-per-view and watch the AI wrestlers fight and commentate over it. And I swear to God, watching those matches is some of the happiest I have ever been. It is such a great game. I have nothing bad to say about it. It's kind of perfect in a lot of ways. I'm not going to talk about how it's aged. I'm not going to talk about any of that. It is a beautiful game. I refuse to say a bad word about it. It was real cozy. And like, I've lost touch with that guy now. Like, that friend I used to do that with, we don't hang out anymore. Just, he kind of disappeared. And it's weird because that's one of those games where like, it's linked to a person for me. And when I think that happens, I think that's really like special and powerful. No, it's not something that belongs in an objective analysis of a game, but like, when the fuck have anything I ever done come close to objective? You know, I don't try and do that, and I don't care. That is I really value those memories, and those memories would not exist without that game. Reminds me of your Sonic video. Okay, real talk, the guy I just talked about is the guy who inspired that character in the Sonic video. His name is not, I can't remember what I called him in the Sonic video. Jake, his name is not Jake, but like, that was all based on like real shit. I just like changed things. There's some deep lore for everybody. Yep, that was a real person. He smoked and everything. He was like my kind of edgier friend who was into a lot of bad shit that I shouldn't have been into, and he would get me in a lot of trouble, but he had his own shit going on, and kind of as we grew up, his kind of life went away and my life went away, and like, we just didn't belong in the same world anymore. And it's kind of sad, but I mean, you know, when a relationship like that ends and you're sad about it, you know it was worthwhile. So anyway, video games. Wait, did the I miss you thing actually happen? No, that did not happen. Unfortunately, there was no happy ending to the real life story. John, you sounded like you were in love with that person in the Sonic video. I mean, yeah, I did. I think next, it's gotta be Gitaru Man. And I love Gitaru Man so fucking much. It is my favorite rhythm game ever. It is one of my favorite games ever. It is so weird and out there. They did something that a lot of people don't do, and I really wish they did more of it, you know? It's basically they found a really weird artist and they built an entire game around his art style, you know? And I love that game. Mechanically, it's very simple and it's a game that sells itself on its presentation and, like, it does some cool stuff with gameplay. Just, like, I think it was, like, the moment I realized I liked weird fucking art. Let's actually pull up a little video of it because it's worth looking at. So, this is Gitaru Man. This is where you fight a bunch of aliens. Hang on, I'm gonna pause the music so we can listen to it for a sec. Oh my god, that game looks so good in 4K. It was such a hard game, but it was great. One of the best games of all time, Jim Sterling agrees. All the songs are this good as well. Like, every... Let's get to the harmony at the end. It's so sick. Are you telling me that this does not elicit great joy in you? Do you not feel like you are witnessing something absolutely beautiful in Gitaru Man? There's a boss later on in Gitaru Man called the Sambone Trio. And I must have fought them like 100 times or something. And when I finally beat them, I like punched the air so hard. Public Loser, I see Devotion. Where can you find that game? You cannot, unfortunately. And it sucks, but you just can't find... Like, it came out and it got pulled down again. You can pirate it, like, which... I'd say if you're gonna pirate it, at least pick up some of Red Candle's other games as well. Because they are a small studio and I'm really worried that, like... I'm really worried what happened with Devotion did them very serious damage, because, like, they're not, like, it's a couple of people, like, I've talked to them, I've chatted to them, and they're really nice, and so, like, I can't, you know, publicly recommend pirating it, but I also accept there's no other way you can play it, but if that's the route you go down, like, buy some of their other games, like, find a way to support them, because they are super, super worth it, and Detention is also excellent. Okay, I think I know what I gotta cut. And this is gonna upset people. But at number 34, it's Resident Evil 4. Resident Evil 4 is a fucking fantastic game. It is, like, one of the closest a video game has ever come to being, like, an amazing action game, action film. That in itself is a problem, because why I don't have a problem with Resident Evil 4 at all, I love it. It was the moment to me that Resident Evil stopped being Resident Evil, and it started to stop being something, like, really quite, like, scary and frightening, and, like, really hitting on some shit to being... It is infinitely replayable, you're absolutely right. I also think it's the moment that, like, one of my favorite series in existence really started... to not be itself, and like 5, 6, 7, I don't like those games, you know? I just, and that's a bummer, like, it really, it bums me out that it's like that, but it's true. I'm not saying, like, it's not Resident Evil, but to me, that's like, that is kind of like what it is, you know? And it sucks, but I think compared to what we have left in this list, I gotta cut something. And I think it has to be Resident Evil. And I think the next couple of cuts, people are going to be so mad. But yeah. To me, it's the old school Resident Evil games that I really love. And RE4 was the first step away from that. But I can't discount, like, what a fucking amazing game it is. Like, I remember graduating from high school. I went out camping with all these guys, like, in the middle of the woods. And these were all, like, my old kind of classmates and stuff. 4 in the morning, I remember, like, we were all hanging out. And I remember just realizing, man... I don't actually like these guys that much, you know what I mean? And so I walked home, I walked 3 hours home in, like, the freezing cold morning, and I took a bus into town, and I bought Resident Evil 4 and End of Evangelion. That was the best summer I ever had. I just played through it over and over, and I played it with my little cousins, and it was just fucking incredible, and I really, really value that. This one's been hanging on for a long time for me. This is gonna make people super mad. I am cutting Half-Life. I think what's so special about Half-Life, it emerged in this conversation when everyone was talking about, like, Unreal Tournament and Quake. And everyone was like, which is gonna be the winner of the shooters? And then Half-Life comes along and made everything else look fucking obsolete in a day. And that was incredible. It's maybe one of the most important games on this list. In terms of my personal feelings towards it, I love it. I spent a lot of time playing it as a teenager. I really did not like Half-Life 2, and the series ended up not meaning a lot to me after that. In fact, if you guys want to talk about Half-Life 2, we can talk about Half-Life 2, but I'm not sure that's somewhere you guys want to go. I think that game gets a lot of credit for inventing seesaw puzzles in games, and honestly, just who gives a shit? But Half-Life 1, I felt like when you look at the advancements that made, it's way more significant in several ways. That's my very hot take on Half-Life. So we're going to move past that. We're going to just keep going. Okay, next up, Secret of Mana. Absolute childhood classic of a game for me. Mechanically, it's not as sophisticated or deep as so many other games on this list. And its story isn't even that good for an RPG. The characters are barely written. But it just has this undeniable fucking X factor. I just don't think you can take away from it. You know, it's like, it's just this weird, like, perfect combination of visuals and sound that really, like, when I was a kid, like, genuinely took me into another world. And I just fucking love it. I want to get some Secret of Mana visuals up on screen. And I want to play some music because people need to understand. Listen to that shit. On a Super Nintendo sound chip. Like, there was something so sad and lonely about this music, but like so ethereal as well. You can't really tell there, this isn't a great quality video, but it just had some of the most charming pixel art in like the whole thing. Nero's got a really fantastic video on Secret of Mana, which I'd check out. But yeah. It's gotta go. There's no two ways about it. This is like Sand Noodle Online. This is like watching Giant Bomb Game of the Year, but it's only John fighting the various versions of himself. Oh, that's what it feels like, though. It's so difficult. And we still have, like, we're coming up to the hardest part. Okay, I have... I know what it is, but hear me out with this one, okay? Just hear me out, okay? The next cut is going to be... Super Smash Bros. For the Switch. If you sum up Smash Bros. As a series and all the games of Smash Bros. Have had, you get like my favorite, maybe my favorite series ever, just something fucking brilliant. I feel like at this point it's impossible to boil that down into one game. Like, I love Smash Bros. Switch. I've played maybe 60 hours of it, and like, I feel like this game could easily be Melee. Hell, like, this game could be Brawl. Like, I played so much Brawl, but like, this is the ranking of the 100 best games of all time for me, not the best series. It has to be that. It has to be Super Smash Bros. For Switch. I hope that makes sense, because like, Smash Bros. Switch is my favorite version of Smash, but like, to really get across why I'd love Smash, we'd have to talk about the whole series as one rather than just like this one game. And so for that reason, I think it has to go. We are now moving into the ascension of the Super Beast, the top 30 games. But before we do, let's read some donations. Koznagi, any thoughts? Any thoughts of doing an anime top 100 next? I'm sure you'll be able to shatter my hopes and dreams in the future. You see, if I did a top 100 anime of all time, it would set off like riots in the anime community. People would make videos about it. Everyone would get so angry about it because that's what anime people do. And it just does not sound like a good time to me, I don't think. And also, this is exhausting. I am like dying trying to make this list. Obviously, people are going to look at my list and be like, well, I don't agree with that. And that's fine. But I would really challenge you guys, like, make your own list and see what it feels like when you have to make these just impossible decisions about games you love so much. Like, it is exhausting. It's fun, but it is tiring. Okay, let's get to it. 30 games left. It's 2 a.m. over here. I want to be finished by 3 a.m. so I can go to bed. I will do my best. This is going to be difficult. Okay. I think the next one is going to be Resident Evil Remake. To me, just the flat out best survival horror game that's ever been made. A just fucking staggering achievement. I think it still looks beautiful, especially in like the remake of the remake, the remaster of the remake, whatever you want to call it. An incredible step forward for games, I thought. And like, it just took so much of what made that like... What took so much of what made Resident Evil amazing and just pushed it even further. And it pushed it, honestly, to a height I don't think any survival horror game, Resident Evil or otherwise, has come close to since. I want something to dethrone it, but I think that is the best survival horror game there is. I fucking adore it, and it's landing at number 30, which at this point, we are talking millimeters between these games. But yeah, next, I'm going to go for Bayonetta 2. My favorite character action game ever. I love it. It's a coin toss between this and Bayonetta, but I just love this game so much. The cutscenes, Bayonetta's attitude, it all comes like through to me better than it did in the first game. There's like an argument to be made that Bayonetta 1 is a much deeper game and in some ways kind of better designed, but I think just the flair of 2 is what pushes it over the edge to me. Wait, Devil May Cry 5 is still here, isn't it? Oh my god, I forgot about that. Hold the phone. No, I love Devil May Cry 5, but it's not better than Bayonetta 2. Hold the phone. Devil May Cry 5, number 29. Guys, you gotta cut me some slack here. It's 2 a.m. I've been streaming this for 4 hours and 20 minutes. My brain's going a little bit, but that feels good for me. That feels good. Look, guys, I don't know what to tell you. I think Bayonetta 2 is a better action game, Devil May Cry 5, by like that much. By that much, but I think it is. Look, that's the only time that's happened, okay? That's the only time, and I'm sticking to it. To me, Devil May Cry 5 is Bloody Palace. I think the rest of that game is good. I think Bloody Palace is where it's at. It's where it teaches you to play that game. You can get through all of Devil May Cry 5 on normal without really knowing how to play that game. I think the hidden depths of Devil May Cry 5 only come out in Bloody Palace. To me, Bayonetta 2 not only has a more varied and exciting campaign, it also teaches you how to play it better to the point that you feel like a fucking ninja playing Bayonetta 2, even if you're not playing it at its highest difficulties. To me, that feeling with Devil May Cry 5 does not come across until you are like floor 60 of Bloody Palace and moving upwards. Yeah, that would be my justification. I think the campaign in Bayonetta 2 is a lot better, and like that's a huge part of it for me. People want to disagree with that, that's fine. But yeah, that would be where I have to go. And yeah, the Virgil DLC is amazing. See, this sucks because I love Devil May Cry 5. It's made it into my top 30 games ever. I know it seems like I'm nearly shit-talking it, but it's an incredible game as well. Like, I love it, but I don't think it's as good as Bayonetta 2. To me, Bayonetta 2 is still like the queen of character action. Okay, next up is Street Fighter Alpha 3. Street Fighter Alpha 3 was the game that got me into fighting games. It was the game that got me into like anime. It was a massively influential piece of art from like where my life would head. Still to me, one of the most beautiful art styles of any fighting game. And like there is stuff with more lavish animation, but just as like, oh god, when you see those character portraits and they're so fun and they're so expressive, nothing beats that for me, and it's so much fun to play still. It's kind of broken in a lot of ways. The character balance is crazy, but Jesus Christ, like air blocking supers and like going down into alpha counters, it was so, so good. And one of the best rosters in fighting games. There is only one Street Fighter game I think is better than it, and that's I think why it's not going to go further. But yeah, the Karen laugh. Oh, it's so good with friends. Do you remember earlier I was talking about Garou and like how I never got in a point where I got to play that with friends? For me, Street Fighter Alpha 3 was that game where me and friends were constantly inventing new tech to outdo each other. And it was just so intense and emotional and just fucking brilliant. Okay, you know, I think while we're on it, Tekken 5 like that occupies a very similar place to me. I think Tekken 5 is still hands down the best Tekken. I think it's a mix of the really cool atmosphere and story from 4. It has one of the best rosters, especially if you factor in the Dark Resurrection characters. Dragunov is amazing. But like those new characters, it was like Raven, Asuka, and the monk guy, Feng Wei, or is that Virtue? The monk dude, those three were so fucking great, and each three had such a strong, like, aesthetic and gameplay style. I played Tekken 5 in arcades. I played all the way to the end of the game, and I beat Jinpachi in the arcade, and I just beat him, and I turned around, and when I did, there was a crowd around me, and they started clapping, and I thought that was the fucking funnest, coolest thing. It's got an amazing soundtrack. For a PS2 game, it looks absolutely sensational. Really cool stages, really cool art direction. It's such a good game, and this feels like the right place for it to be. Okay, next up, we have Legend of the Mystical Ninja, Ganbore Goemon. At some point, I may have said that this is one of my top five games of all time. In hindsight, maybe that was a little generous. I think top 25 games of all time is more accurate. It has maybe some difficulty spikes that are a little unjustified. If anyone ever sends, no one's allowed to clip this. Don't anyone send this to Wooly, okay? I am forbidding this to ever reach him. I'll never hear the fucking end of it, okay? I love this game. I love this game so, so much. It has maybe my favorite art style on the Super Nintendo, some of my favorite pixel art. It is absolutely fucking great. And no matter what Wooly says, I still love the game design of this game. Hitting stuff feels so good. Those levels are so imaginative and fun. 25 feels like the right place for it. It hurts. It really does to cut it. But yeah, this is as far as it goes. Okay, let's keep moving. Jesus, we're getting in it now, guys. Okay, I got it. At number 24... we have Wind Waker. I love Wind Waker. I fucking love Wind Waker. I think it is one of the most, like, imaginative best Zeldas. It's much better to me than any Zelda game in the last decade. I absolutely adore it. Its art style is one of the best art style in games. I love the gameplay. It's a little easy, but I still really like it. I liked the Triforce hunting. I thought all that stuff was good. I liked that. But I can't put it ahead of Majora's Mask. I can't put it ahead of Ocarina of Time. There's a lot of stuff I can't put it ahead of on this list. And yeah, like, there's going to be a lot of Zelda games in these top, but that's how much I love Zelda. And what I'd say is I think each of them really do their own thing. And that's what Wind Waker did. I really respect Nintendo for, like, making such a... they swerved everyone, you know? It seemed like Zelda was going to be this dark, edgy, adult thing, and they went the complete opposite way of it and fucking killed it. I would say maybe the best last boss fight of any Zelda as well. Just absolutely fucking amazing. Okay, I know which is next. Next up, I am cutting Final Fantasy VI. A lot of people love Final Fantasy VI. A lot of people will tell you it is the best Final Fantasy. I don't think that's a bad opinion, but it ain't mine. I love that game, especially like from like a kind of world building art wise. The shit they do with Kefka is amazing. The shit they do with your party is amazing. It's a great game. Like, it is a fantastic game. Like, look at how high it has made it on this list, okay? But for me, it's like, I think a lot of people's favorite Final Fantasies is their first Final Fantasy. And I don't know how true that is, but for me, I came to it after 7 and it just felt like a step backwards. I think I don't have the personal connection to it. A lot of people do, and this is as far as it can go for me. Like, I think it's an amazing game. I think it's beautiful. I think what it does with the characters is so cool. Some of the stuff doesn't hit home with me in the same way I think it does for some people. And like, I like all the characters of Final Fantasy VII a lot. I don't love any of them. And I think that is ultimately where the game doesn't go further for me. Okay. Next game, Dead Rising. I'm guessing for a lot of people, it is bewildering how Dead Rising made it this far. It's an awkward ass game. It's like got like really weird save mechanics. It's so janky to get your head around, but when you do, I still think this game offers just a kind of experience like nothing else does. I think it offers that like perfect B-movie tone. To me, after this, Dead Rising got too zany and completely lost it. But like the psychopath battles, all that kind of stuff, I feel like it captured so beautifully this really cheesy feeling of being trapped in a mall for an outbreak, and I had so much fun with it. I basically got this game at the start of one summer, and I played it over and over and over, and I think I beat it around 8 times or something, and I had such an incredible time with it. And the way every single weapon you can pick up has like its own weight and feel, and like there's so many weird little like ways, and then like you start, basically it kind of does a Majora's Mask, not a Majora's Mask thing, you basically have 3 days to solve the mystery of the shopping mall, and you can just run around and do stupid shit the entire time, or you can just follow everything. And I think it's actually a really fascinating piece of game design. And like, to be honest with you, like, there's games with better stories, there's games that look better, there's games with better characters. I don't know that there's many games on this list I think are more fun than Dead Rising. Like, for pure fun factor, I fucking love it so much. And I know a lot of people aren't going to agree with that, but I genuinely think it's one of the coolest games I've ever played. And still one of my favorites. And like, still something I could end this stream and just go play and have a great time with. I think it's a weird game because, like, if you don't like it, I think there's a lot of good reasons not to like it, but if it clicks with you like it does me, there's really nothing else like it still, and I adore it for that reason. Okay, Mass Effect 2 at number 21. I adore Mass Effect 2. My favorite Mass Effect game, one of my favorite RPGs of all time. Some of my favorite characters ever. I love Garrus. I love everyone on that ship. They're like, well, the what's her name? The bald girl I wasn't crazy about, but she was still fun. Jack, like, in her own way, she, like, made interesting friction with those other characters. I love the story. I love the writing. I still think it's the peak of Mass Effect, and it's interesting. Like, the writing and the dialogue in that game is so good. I always remember the first speech from Mass Effect 3. I remember listening to it and thinking, that's not right. That's not the right tone. And I went and I looked, and surely the lead writer from Mass Effect 2 was no longer working on Mass Effect 3, and I knew it. I think the shooting mechanics could be better. I still think it does cool things with shooting mechanics. Should one start with 2? I actually started with 2, and I found that a really fine way to get into the series, so yeah, I think you can. Garrus, Tali, Grunt, and Legion were my favorites. Like, exactly, like, even those, just those guys were fucking brilliant. Okay, we're at the top 20. We're just gonna keep rolling here. We are in the battle on heavenly ground. This is it. For me, the next game is Majora's Mask. What a weird, broken, special game. The weirdest Zelda game. So fucking out there and interesting. I can't believe that what is basically an asset reuse of Ocarina of Time could be such a profoundly weird and interesting experience. Its mechanics have been talked to death. It's like, the idea, it's so dark and nihilistic, but then, like, so hopeful as well. And, like, just that whole town and learning to know that town and, like, the different intricacies of how they interact with each other. It's fucking brilliant. It's about death. Yeah, like, it is a Legend of Zelda game about death and dying and the inevitability and learning to accept that. It is a fucking exceptional game. I think there's, like, a few rough edges. Nothing that I feel like is even worth bringing up. But it stands at number 20, which brings us to number 19. I think it's gotta be Paper Mario and the Thousand Year Door. Fucking incredible game. One of the best RPGs of all time. And it's so difficult, like, it's so difficult explaining that to people who haven't played it, but, like, the writing in that game is so sharp, the art direction is amazing, it's just such a fantastic fucking game, and, like, the battle system is one of the cleverest and tightest I've ever played. I think the only thing that keeps it from going higher to me is, I think, nearly everything else on this list I either had, like, a massive, like, personal connection to, or, like, change the game's industries. And, like, I have a hugely, like, personal connection to Thousand Year Door in that I think it's really, really good. It tells a nice story, but, like, it's not a story that I feel ever really, like, emotionally hit me the way, like, the best RPGs kind of can do. And I think that's the only thing it's missing. I think, like, if you put, like, a really emotionally impactful story in there, we'd be talking, like, top 5. And honestly, I'm kind of shocked to see it out this early. But yeah, it's that kind of thing. When I look at what's left, it is difficult to really justify it ahead of them. Okay, so I see people, like, kind of leaving, like, kind of various opinions about Red Dead Redemption 2. Red Dead 2 is, like, an interesting one for me because I feel like I'm kind of with you on a lot of them, right? Because, like, I played Red Dead 2 and I played it for, like, 20 hours and I put it down and I was like, okay, it seems pretty cool, but, like, I think that's enough for me. I think I might just go read the Wikipedia. Then afterwards, I was taking some time off from YouTube and I was kind of in a shitty place and I sat down and I just spent every day playing Red Dead Redemption 2. And that's kind of, like, the ideal way to play that game, you know? And I got so invested in that world and characters and just the story of, like, how that dude just fucking fell apart and, like, what it said about death and legacy and, like, familial bonds. I thought it was just fucking amazing. But I'm going to talk a bit more on that when we cut it. And that's not going to be now. Yeah, I genuinely think Arthur is one of the best protagonists in any game. But I'll talk about that more in a sec. Okay, you know what? Next, I'm cutting Pokemon Blue. I know kind of people are like, how did that make it this far? And with Pokemon Blue, like, what you gotta understand is I was there on the ground level when Pokemon wasn't a thing. Pokemon wasn't... There was no convention for Pokemon. You could not understand it. You couldn't say it was like Pokemon games because Pokemon games didn't exist. And then me and my dad wandered into a shop called Mr. Calculator in Dublin, Ireland, and by some miracle, they had an American import of it. And I downloaded it, and I took it home, and I swear to God, that game hypnotized me harder than I've ever been hypnotized by any game. It was fucking amazing. And I remember just raising my Bulbasaur. Like, I didn't know what my Bulbasaur was going to evolve into. Can you imagine how exciting that is? How exciting that was, you know? And it was such an amazing experience. I also remember, like, I hung out with these kids. I know a lot of these stories kind of end with me being like, and then I never saw that person again. But I was hanging out with these kids I didn't like because they were kind of mean and shitty. And at some point, I was like, I'd be having a way better time if I went indoors and played Pokemon. And I did. And I never saw those kids. I stopped hanging out with those kids because Pokemon was better than them. Pokemon Blue was better than some people I know. That's how good it is. Incredible game, completely groundbreaking, started one of the biggest media franchises on the earth. I adore it. Okay, next up, Super Mario World. I don't even know what you can say about this game, but I can tell you, like, going from Super Mario Land 3 to Super Mario World was the most insane shit. Looking into a screen playing Super Mario World was like looking at fucking magic. That's what you felt like you were seeing when like it first came out. It's so fun, it's so weird, it's so creative. It is still one of the best games ever. I don't think it's aged a single day. Again, I think maybe some of the games left on this list have more of an emotional punch for me than that game. But I still adore it, and I'd still just like play it for hours. It's still fucking great. Bad proof of concept, overrated, my own experience. You see, it could be, but it's always hard to say unless you were there for a game that monumental that did shit that differently. So you could say that, like, different platformers might be better than it now, but man, at the time, like, it was just so good. Okay, for now, it's gotta be Virtua Fighter 4 Evolution. The best 3D fighting game in existence. I love this game so much. One of the best rosters ever. It's just pure fighting game perfection. But the real X factor of this game for me is its single player. This had a gigantic single player mode with all these AI controlled fighters. So you would wander around to different arcades and you would fight these AI controlled characters that all played like their own individual characters and fighting style. And I always remember there was this one fucking character and he was called Lee Bai. And I could never beat him. And then, like, I went through the whole game with him demolishing me every time. And then in the, like, very last stage of the game, I entered a tournament in the biggest arcade there was. And in the finals, it was me and Lee Bai. And I was so pissed because I knew I wasn't going to beat him. And, like, it took ages to get there. And I was like, going to have to get here all over again. And then in, like, one of the most clutch matches I've ever had, I beat this AI-controlled opponent. And it was just elative. It was the best feeling and it was incredible. It added Go, one of my favorite fighting game characters ever, and it had some of the best, for the time, customization options in any game. Beautiful game. In some ways, I don't think fighting games have ever had as good single player options as that did, and I wish they would go back and take influence from it, because it's incredible. Guys, top 15. Here we are. We're doing it. We're nearly there. I actually thought it would go further, but I think at this point, I gotta drop Devotion. Devotion is the second best horror game I've ever played. It's from a tiny Taiwanese studio. It feels like it has the, like, production quality of, like, a AAA film. I have an entire video on Devotion, so I'm not going to say too much about it. But I think it is a profoundly sad and frightening game about how when we are at our lowest and most desperate, the most insidious aspects of, like, society can just creep into us and ruin everything. And I think it's a real fucking, like, it's supernatural and it's weird and it's spooky, but it's all it's all based on real shit, like, and that's what I love from horror, you know, when it takes, like, this real life stuff and takes it to this whole other level. And, like, Devotion isn't just one of the best horror games I've ever played, it's one of the best pieces of horror I've experienced, games, movies, books, anything. It's just fucking beautiful, and, like, I hate saying this, it is a piece of art. If anyone is not done with that tired ass argument of where games are, whether games are art or not, Devotion is the kind of game I would show them. Will anyone ever be able to play it? God, I fucking hope so. I actually thought Devotion would go higher. I'm kind of sad that it hasn't, but yeah. Next up is gonna be Red Dead Redemption 2. Red Dead Redemption 2 is a game with so many fucking problems. It is so awkward. The shooting is so repetitive. Everything takes so long and it drags out, and the game itself is way too fucking long. There's like any number of things, and like the mission structure, this should be a game, I feel like, about like being able to approach different problems your own way. You know, you should be able to do all that shit in it, but every mission feels like it has this linear ass, like, do it this exact way, and if you go outside this way, you'll fail, and all that kind of stuff. But despite all of that, I still think it is an absolutely incredible game, and one of the best stories games have ever fucking told. And I feel like there's so much in there about, like, non-biological families and the legacy you leave behind in a way that is just so fucking profound. Like, I don't know how else to describe it, you know? There's that one scene between Arthur and I think it's Jesse. It's the girl who joins your group. Her name escapes me right now. But he has that line where he's like, "We're more ghosts than people." And, like, it's so fucking, like, you know when you're just trapped in a particular mindset and you're obsessed with the way things were, like, 4 or 5 years ago or whatever? It is a game about that. It is a game about being just trapped by your past and wanting to move on and wanting to escape, but completely being unable to. And that is so fucking tragic and beautiful that, yeah, I get it. I get that there's so many problems in that game, but, like, when it tells a story that fucking good, I have no choice but to say it's, like, the 14th best game of all time, you know? And, like, it does it through the gameplay. You're just walking around. You spend, like, 30, 40 hours of as Arthur, and your body is fine. You're okay. And next thing, you fall off your fucking horse on this mission, and the set, and, like, how strongly does that communicate the idea of sickness, that there is something really fucked in your body and you're going to die? Nothing has ever made me feel like that before. And so, like, I get it. It's a controversial game, it's divisive, but the shit it does well, it does better than maybe anything else. And that would be my justification behind putting this at number 14. Okay. Number 13. Lisa the Painful. I love Lisa the Painful. I love it so much. I feel like a lot of what I just said about Red Dead Redemption 2 could be applied to Lisa, except it takes 6 hours. It is one of the most tragic games I've ever played. This absolutely made me cry, this game. Like, it was, it's again about a deeply broken person. You're playing as this man who's addicted to drugs, and then he finds, I don't want to say too much because I really just want people to play it, he finds a new reason to live, and then things go wrong. And it is just a game about being being trapped in this violent, cruel world. There are no right decisions, everything is always against you, and it's fucking beautiful, you know? It is just a game where there is always bad. There's bad things always happen, and you just have to go with it, and it's incredible. There's parts of it that are rough. The battle system's a little rough. Some of, like, the way you navigate the world kind of sucks. The lows of the game are so far eclipsed by its highs. Please go play that game. Whew. Okay. At number 12, it's Super Mario 64. Super Mario 64 is an incredible game. It's still an incredible game. It was the first proper, legitimate, well-playing 3D game. And that's fucking amazing. And, like, even back then, I know I talked about earlier about, like, Super Mario Worlds being, like, looking into another world, like, into a new reality. Super Mario 64 was, like, that times 10. It just destroyed my brain trying to figure out what that game was. But when you got it, and you realized it was actually a fucking amazing game that played good, Nintendo nailed it, like, the first try, and in doing so, fucking changed video games, you know? Like, they changed everything with this one fucking game. There are games that I like better than on this list. I don't know that there is a more important game on this list. I genuinely don't. That's why it's not going further than this, but yeah. Number 11, Link to the Past. I think the moment that the Zelda franchise really ascended to greatness and just became what it is, you know? And I know 11's going to be low for some people, but I have played that game, cleared it, I'd say about 4 or 5 times, and I adore it. In a lot of ways, maybe it deserves to go higher, but to me, Ocarina of Time is the better game and a more important game, and I know not everyone's going to agree with that, but I just, that's what I got to go with. Okay. Guys, we have reached the top 10. It is 3 a.m. We are going to finish this. And at number 10, I think it's gotta be Yakuza 0. I think personally, the game I like most from the last generation. It's tough. It is close to my favorite game from the last generation. It's a fucking brilliant game. It is a just tremendous game. One of my favorite stories ever. One of the most fun stories ever. Like, just some of the best character writing, some of the best interactions, just everything about it. One of the most beautifully presented games ever. Like, one of my problems with Yakuza 7 is I feel like the presentation has slipped so much, and if you go back and watch some Yakuza 0 cutscenes, you'll see what I mean. Like, it's, they have these beautifully rendered 60 frames per second cutscenes, and it makes the game feel so cinematic and fucking meaningful, and there's all these tiny little pieces of, like, detail to all these really subtle interactions between characters, and I feel like you've really lost a lot of that from Yakuza 7. That makes me sad. But it also, it took Majima, this fucking insane character, and it's like, here's how this well-mannered, low-key Yakuza turns into, like, you know, the mad dog. And it was just such an amazing story. And, like, at the heart of this game, I really think it's about just being a good person. You know, just doing what's right for the people around you, doing what's right for, you know, others. And it's such a simple message, but I thought the way they conveyed it was so powerful. In that last scene, and I'm not going to say it is, but when you watch that person walk away and you realize the weight of that and what Majima is giving up, that fucking destroys me every time. I could watch that now and I would bawl like a baby. And that is the strength of that game. Like, I think it is about doing what is right when what is right is totally fucking impossible, and it's incredible. Okay, next. Metal Gear Solid 2, the number 9 best game of all time. I adore Metal Gear Solid 2. I love it so, so, so much. I don't have it in me to really shit talk any game on this list. I'd just be like pulling at things for the sake of it. Metal Gear Solid 2, I think, was one of the first times I started to feel like games could do things that other mediums couldn't. When you get to the end of it and it breaks the fourth wall and tells you to turn off your own PlayStation, that was like a profoundly fucked moment for me. Because I guess you had, like, the Psycho Mantis moments from 1, but I really feel like the Psycho Mantis moments were these quirky little bits in that game, but the way, like, Metal Gear Solid 2, you get to the end of it and it just fucking breaks and everything is insane, like, that really messed with me in a way that I just was so fascinated by and loved. And I thought, like, its level of storytelling, its writing, to me, it was all above anything I'd seen before. And, like, the level of cinematics, I beat it 7 or 8 times. I played it on European Extreme and got to the fighter jet, and I couldn't get past the fighter jet, but it doesn't matter. I think that's an amazing game, and I haven't gone back and played it in a long time, but I really want to. I thought the bait and switch with Raiden was the biggest fuck you to the fans, and I love that stuff. Like, how ahead of it was it? How ahead of that game was its time? Talking about, like, memes and all that kind of shit? Like, incredible. I think it's very easy to make the argument that Metal Gear Solid 3 is a better game. I like 2 better. it just, it hit home so much harder for me. And like the weird meta shit it does, I prefer that to like the kind of Bond action film stuff of 3. So, and that's entirely personal preference. You know, I'm not making the argument it's the better game, just that it's the better game on this list and it's way better than Hades. Okay, next up. At number 8. It's Ocarina of Time. Ocarina of Time, I mean, like, what else can you say about Ocarina of Time? Just a fucking profound moment for game design. At the time, it was one of the best games ever made. It still is. The step forward they took with Ocarina of Time, I don't think they've taken as significant a step forward since then, and I think trying to argue they have is an exercise in futility. It took Legend of Zelda, and it brought it into 3D for the first time, and that should have been a fucking disaster. It should have been the worst thing ever, and it wasn't. It was just this, like, in a lot of ways, one of the first, like, 3D open world games. And, like, you had stuff like Shenmue and Oblivion and stuff that would come later. But Ocarina of Time was like, okay, this isn't a level. Like, this isn't a stage. This isn't a path for you to clear. This is a world. Go fucking play in it. And, like, that is a profound moment in game design, and I still have so little that makes me feel like that did. Like, it was incredible, and I still love that game. Absolutely love that game. The 3DS remake of it is excellent, but yeah, that's the most I could say about it. Just a profound moment in game design. I'm second guessing myself now. I'm feeling like maybe it should have gone further. But no, Ocarina of Time is where it goes. Okay. Number 7. Dark Souls. When I talked about the step forward that Ocarina of Time took, I think the next game that made me feel like that was Dark Souls. And it didn't do it, like, through an open world or, like, through a kind of revolutionary concept like that. But it did it through, I feel like, reshuffling a lot of game design that people took for granted and just creating this brutal fucking reality that just shook, like, what games were to its core. Like, I think, to me, like, the most influential game of last generation is Dark Souls. The whole Dark Souls with meme, it's like every game, every fucking game, like, from the biggest to the smallest, took influence from Dark Souls, and I still think, like, it is beautiful. I think, if you want to make the argument that Bloodborne's a better game, I'm not going to argue with you there. I think Bloodborne has several things over Dark Souls. But in terms of, like, the imagination of some of those bosses, like, meeting Great Grey Wolf Sif for the first time, it's fucking crazy. And, like, the triumph, when you get to the end of that game, when you fight your way through the nightmares of Dark Souls, and the last boss is an old man in a cave, it's the saddest, most beautiful fucking thing, you know what I mean? I think it's an incredible game. I feel like I can't really say much more about it because so much has already been said. Okay, yeah, someone just mentioned this in the chat, but, like, moments like Sif remembering you, or, like, you've beat Sif, this fucking so, like, difficult a boss, and in his last moments, he doesn't try and kill you, he just try and walks away from you. Like, there's that quote from Miyazaki where he's like, he wants the monsters of Dark Souls to have, like, a kind of dignity to them. And it's things like that that make that game so special, because, like, these monsters are horrifying, but they're kind of believable as creatures that could exist in this world, and that makes them scarier, but it makes them more real. Yeah, it's amazing. Oh my god, I've been through these games so many times in my head, and it's like an impossible puzzle. I can't fucking do it. Okay. I have made my decision, and this is keeping in mind that there is millimeters between these games. I love all these games so much. And if you ask me to, like, do this list again tomorrow, these could all be in a different order, okay? But this game, the next game I'm cutting, is Undertale. Look, I fucking love Undertale so much. I literally did I dedicated 5 weeks of my life to just Undertale. I love this game. I love it so fucking much. I think it is a profoundly beautiful game. I think the thing it says about video games, and I know like it's easy to be like, oh, violence is not the right option. I think it does so much more than that, and it's not even like, it's less even about what it does, but how effectively it does it. The way that game builds a relationship with the player, gets you fucking invested, I think is incredible. I think it is genuinely one of the biggest step forwards for games in terms of like philosophy in the longest time, and I wish there were more games like it. You know, I wish more shit did what Undertale did. Like, I really adore that game. I think it's beautiful, and I think the idea that it was born on the internet from a Kickstarter, spread through the internet by Tumblr, YouTube, all this kind of stuff, it is in a very real sense a video game that exists because of the internet. It is like a modern video game, and it's fucking great, you know? I really love it. It is one of my top six games of all time. Of all time. And it makes me sad to drop it at number six, but this is what I gotta do. If you wanna know why I love this game, you can go watch my recent video on it, which I'm guessing a lot of you already have done, but it's there. Okay. Top five video games. At number five, it's gonna be Capcom versus SNK2. The second best fighting game that's ever existed. The best roster that's ever existed. Just fucking absolutely brilliant game. Incredible art style. I love the story of the fighting tournament that gets interrupted for like my like personal development and the things I was into. Profoundly impactful on like getting into anime, getting into fighting games, getting into all these different characters and just loving them so much. I played Sagat, I played Kami, I played the King of Fighters guy, why can't I remember his name? The King of Fighters guy, the blonde guy who does like the whip attacks. Endlessly customizable game, and it's fucking incredible. Okay, so number four is gonna be Street Fighter 3 Third Strike. I don't know how else to describe this game other than just the most meticulously perfect fighting game I've ever played. Street Fighter 3 is infinite. Street Fighter 3 is just, I could play it forever and never feel like I know everything about that game. I feel like every character is such a different, unique fighting style, except for Ryu and Ken. I have played it, been playing it for like 15 years, and I still feel like a beginner at it, and I love that. Like, I love the end, like, I love the endless depth that comes with that game, and a lot of it is just, it provides you with a defensive system that if you get good enough at, can get you out of literally every fucking like dangerous situation you could be in if you have like the reaction time and just the fucking balls to do it. And I love it. Artistically, music wise it's tens across the board. I cannot fault Street Fighter 3, and that's less than I could say about the other games on this list. I think Street Fighter 3 Third Strike is the most perfect game on this list. I just like three other games slightly more. Oh, it's 3:30 a.m. and I'm so tired and this is so hard. The number three best game of all time is Silent Hill 2. My favorite story in any video game. A just profoundly upsetting, sad narrative just about like how loss fucking destroys you and how grief leaves you just obliterated, you know, and just lost in yourself. And it does it all in a way a film never could, a book never could, and like you don't even fucking realize you're playing it. You don't know what's going on in that game until the very end, and the way it just changes everything is insane. You know, and it's, goddamn, it is such a fucking beautiful game. And like, one of the biggest regrets I have is not talking about that ending in the video. Like, not dropping a spoiler warning and just going into it full ham. Like, in my original Silent Hill 2 video, which I made like years ago. I think, to me, like, it's a game that deals with mental illness. It's a game that deals with just getting trapped in your own fucking reality and not being able to make your way out. And it's like, it's devastating, and it's beautiful. Like, it is a game about pain. It is a game about life handing you things you cannot handle, and I love it so much, and I love the performances so much. I love how it looks. It's just, it is an exceptionally beautiful game, and it would be 100% worthy of, you know, the game of the year, and it's only for these two other slightly better games. Okay. So now the only question is, what is the greatest game of all time? We've gone through 100 games. We've gone through the Shadow Realm. We've gone through everything, and it's come down to just this. Okay, people are saying they're still mad about Yakuza 7. So you know what? Chat, I'm going to take Yakuza... I'm going to do something unprecedented, and I'm going to take Yakuza 7 out of the dead zone. You have my word. Because what if there was a place below the dead zone? What if there was somewhere even worse than the dead zone? What if I left Yakuza 7 in the void of nothing? That's what you get. That's what you all get for disagreeing with me. The void of nothing. The worst place imaginable, and that's where we will leave it forever. Would I accept an impassioned argument for Shadow the Hedgehog? No. No, I would not. Look, video game lists are stupid. Ranking lists are stupid. Whole purpose of this stream was basically just raise some money for a good cause, and I'm really super proud of everyone that we did that. I know I've made a lot of decisions to piss people off. I'm okay with that. But ultimately, I'm glad people enjoyed the stream, and I'm glad, you know, it provided a bit of levity for someone, and I'm really glad that I decided to do it for, like, you know, the American Foundation of Suicide Prevention in particular. I was talking about this earlier in the stream, but 2020 fucking was a shit year. It was a shit year for everyone. I feel like I was one of the people least affected by it, but it still sucked for me, and I can't imagine how it was for other people. And, you know, as I said earlier, part of why I wanted to do this stream is kind of like destigmatize in whatever little way I can the talk around kind of suicide and mental health and that kind of stuff, because we still don't talk about that shit enough. Like, we just don't. And we've gotten a lot of messages from people tonight talking about how, you know, they've been through their own shit, and like, it always helps to know that other people have, and like, no one's alone in this. Like, there other people do care. It's just not always obvious. And like, if you are struggling, there are resources out there, and no one should ever have to deal with that shit alone, ever. And, you know, if you are, it's not something you should have to take on board by yourself. Like, serious misery, depression, anxiety, that is not stuff that you should have to tolerate in your own life. And if you are, like, all I can say is just, like, you know, go get help. Like, there's absolutely a time when I was, like, depressed, like, so far beyond anything I'd ever dealt with, and I did go on, like, you know, I got therapy and I got help with it, and that was one of the best decisions I ever made, you know. And when I think about the amount of time I spent convincing myself it wasn't a good idea and it wasn't for me, in hindsight that was so dumb, and I felt like it would have been a lot healthier for me to get it quicker, but I didn't. And so, if you know, people take anything away from this, is like, you know, don't be too proud. Like, everyone needs help with shit, and if you are suffering, you don't need to be, like, you don't deserve that, and don't do that to yourself. I felt like that was worth saying in this really ridiculous stream about ranking which video games are better than other video games. And I've had a blast with this stream. I'm exhausted now, but this has been really fucking cool, and just, you know, really appreciate everyone who turned up. But we have one final decision to make here. Out of 926 votes, 55% for Mother 3, 45% for Final Fantasy 7. The chat is leaning Mother 3. Okay. I think I've made a decision. The number one best game of all time, according to me, is Raid Shadow Legends. Do you want an epic game that lets you gather all the loot you can? Are you eager to play with friends and fight this array of amazing characters? Then Raid Shadow Legends is the game for you. Available now on all free devices. Well, guys, that's gonna do it. Thanks everyone for joining my stream. I had a fun time. It's been good. I think there was a lot of difficult decisions there. But ultimately we did it. And I had a good time. So I think, you know, that's gonna do it for the stream. And have a good night, guys. Mother 3 is the number 2 game on this list. I love Mother 3. Mother 3 is a just fucking profoundly hilarious, sad, amazing game about what losing a family member can do to you. I don't have it much in me to convey why I think that game is so good, but I think it just shows, like, through this, like, really hilarious, quirky, beautiful world, it just shows you the dissolution of this family, and it's the most heartbreaking fucking thing. There's another game on this list that made me fucking bawl, and I love it, and I will never not love it for that. It breaks, like, the fourth wall in some really incredible ways, and I think it's just a masterpiece, complete masterpiece. And there's only one other game I would put slightly above it, and that is Final Fantasy VII. If you want to know why this is my favorite game of all time, you can go watch my fucking 50-minute video for it, where I go into everything. But I think what I really love about Final Fantasy VII is through everything, it is a game that kind of just looks at you and just says, you are enough. And I think that's something that we all need to hear every now and then. And I don't feel a need to justify it any more than that. And guys, that's going to do it for this stream. I really hope you all had a good time. I did. I'm like exhausted. But it was like, this was so much fun. And I had a really, really good time. And we've been at this for 6 hours. It's currently nearly 4 a.m. in Ireland. And I am going to go to bed. But this was a blast. Okay, guys, I'm going to call it there. You can donate more, but I won't be able to read them because my voice is going. I love you all. Thank you for a beautiful stream. And I'll catch you guys next time.